Bodega, part uno.
Oh. I'm hoping that this is going to be like Gentleman Broncos.
You'll see. All right. Okay.
Can we just interrupt any time?
Of course, okay? No, feel free.
Okay.
As bars go, the Shit Rivet Tavern took sleazy and redefined the word. A trio of spurloopian strippers outnumbered the lone customer, but ground the pole on stage with real menace regardless.
Are you masturbating?
No.
Okay, good.
I was clapping.
I'm not quite there yet. I'm getting close, though.
Behind the chrome-top bar, hunched and moodier than a mork beast, Jargel Floop gazed dully at the tiny vid screen embedded in his left forearm. An empty glass slid down the bar, and with honed reflexes unique to a veteran bartender, Floop caught it, filled it, and returned it with gusto without glancing up. It was the fifth pint of ale the human in the corner had swigged, but it was five times the business Floop had the previous night, so he wasn't complaining. After a spell, the melancholy was broken when the front doors creaked open. Floop saw four figures in desert cloaks, dust masks fashioned across their faces, scanning the room from the doorway. Their eyes settled on the human ale swigger at the far end of the bar. They broke formation. Two sat at tables either side of the door. One sat a ways behind the ale swigger, and the fourth approached the bar with all the cockiness of a Krell sluicer. Barkeep, one beverage.
I love the random alien names.
It's set in space, right?
It's just like George Lucas 2.0.
Barkeep. One beverage, lady's choice, said the burly interloper, nodding towards one of the spurloopians who was taking a break from swinging her big old titties.
Oh, shit! Out of nowhere!
The spurloopian
titties! Oh, my God! Fuck me.
Give him two fingers of fuck monster, Floop, she slurred.
Oh shit! Oh, I'm not ready. I was not prepared.
Floop grinned and poured the black liquor into the traditional phallic drinking vessel and gently pushed it towards the man. Leaning in close, the stranger peeled back his face mask, revealing row after row of razor-sharp off-world combat teeth.
Oh, yes.
He had no way of knowing Floop was odontophobic, so it really was just one of those weird coincidences typical of a space saloon. Put the chompers away, mister. Can't you see my friend here is odontophobic? Said the ale swigger from the corner. Floop looked stunned. How could this guy have known about his odontophobia? Unless... Bodega, said the tooth guy. Said the tooth guy, grimacing. It is you, Bodega, said Floop, turning. He'd not recognize his old compadre and cursed himself for it. Bodega always had money, and he could have charged 5 skrells for the ales instead of 3. Then it dawned on Floop, if Bodega was here and these 4 guys were here, it could only mean one thing. There was about to be one flarve of a good fight.
Oh, man.
You're coming with us, Bodega, like it or not, said Chompers, smiling to show off his fancy gnashes. Floop blinked hard. When he opened his eyes less than a second later, the 4 interlopers lay dead, and Bodega sat finishing the last of his ale. His famous lasgun lay smoking atop the chrome bar. Great moons of Shaboth, you ain't lost your touch, boy, exclaimed Floop. And you're still slower than a glorb worm with the ales, said Bodega, grinning. He played the fight back in his mind. He'd seen the 4 fellows follow him, of course, and had calibrated his lasgun to instantly pierce their Shrovian armor. Just as Chompers had turned to grin at Bodega, he'd taken a shot, refracting the lasgun beam off those shiny dentures to perfectly strike all 3 Goombas right in the heart, killing them instantly. Then, to finish off the leader, he'd simply angled the lasgun beam up off the 3rd incisor in row 5, lower, and turned the leader's brain into Vomanian swamp noodle soup.
Man.
Bodega, said Floop, grinning. Yep, said Bodega, also grinning, but laconically. Bodega, said Floop, still grinning and nodding. Uh-huh, said Bodega. Bodega, said Floop. Still grinning. Okay, this was getting weird, so Bodega paid and left. The end.
Oh, magnificent.
Oh, my Lord.
Magnificent P-Flex. That was...
Oh, that was amazing.
Oh, my God.
Thank you so much.
Honestly, I could listen to that for hours. Although,
I gotta readjust myself.
the amount of aliens that you created, that universe, is so fleshed out already.
Yeah, you know, man, you can feel
it. You know, Chris Metzen left Blizzard, Flax, and there's an opening for his job. I feel like you could get in there, man. You could be like, the
Chris
next
Metzen,
big thing.
But
like,
with bad fanfic sci-fi about Bodega.
Oh my,
gentlemen?
Yeah?
It's time.
It is.
Bodega.
All right, okay. Let me get comfortable. Hang on a second.
We've exhausted all other...
Okay, I got to put my feet up, and I have to recline a bit on my chair and close my eyes as well.
Bodega, part dos. A grey canopy of fog gave way to the brilliant Skirlian dawn. Four suns rising as one, reminding Bodega of the time he almost got run over by a recreational hover vehicle on Platos 4. He slipped his sunglasses into position over his
eyes.
You're
like Metzen 2.0, I'm serious. It's crazy.
And squinted down the sights of his las gun back towards his Gretham stealth insertion shuttle. Nobody mooching about nearby, so he felt secure enough in his position. With the sun at his back, he'd learnt this trick in sniper school, where he'd finished top of his class and all the other classes in the history of that sniper school and all other sniper schools. He settled into the loose soil of his hilltop vantage point and checked the lasgun pivot bipod once more. The action was as smooth as a slim hound's udder. With the pivot bipod deployed, he'd be able to wreak a terrible revenge on the bastard smugglers down in the valley. There they were now, drinking cups of synth tea and smoking their star vapes. Vaping had been outlawed by the evil Federation director, Krem Slumdump. But those cabrones...
Slumdump!
But those cabrones obviously felt the law didn't extend to them. Bodega laughed to himself. Hell, he loved a good vape too. Bodega wanted to vape really, really badly, but it might give away his position, since he was using an advanced mega vape capable of blanketing a small moon in delicious vape smoke. Enough about vaping, thought Bodega.
Hang on a second.
I love the vaping tangent. Oh,
it's got a little bit of sort of Mary Sue character going.
Lots of people vape, Lewis, and as it happens, Bodega happens to use a mega vape capable of blanketing a small moon delicious vape smoke.
I'm delighted to hear
that. That sounds very antisocial, though. I mean, what if the whole moon doesn't want to vape? You know,
enough about vaping, thought Bodega. The smugglers were gathered around a collection of small remote-controlled vehicles. Through the vision scope attachment of his las gun, Bodega could practically smell the scum from here. Whatever they planned to do with those RC vehicles, it was going to be related somehow to their smuggling activities, and it was surely going to be a thing a bastard would do. He'd done research on these bastards before he'd taken the mission. Their list of crimes was so long he'd had to take a couple of extra days off just to read through it and get really, really angry. Bodega liked getting really, really angry. It focused his mind, made him sharp. So sharp he'd come up with the idea for the pivot bipod while he was taking a crap. Bodega's famous las gun, known throughout the galaxy as the best of the best of the best in terms of las guns and one of a kind, was capable of a sustained beam which in turn was capable of penetrating the hull of any ship he'd ever shot it at, which was a lot of ships. By definition, a human being in their stupid remote control vehicles was going to be no match. No match at all. He grinned, he being Bodega, and checked the pivot bipod action once more, smoother than a hit from his mega vape. No! No vaping, thought Bodega firmly.
Man.
Down in the valley, the bastard scum smugglers were laughing and joking and starting to fart around with their RC vehicles. There were 10 of them, their hover vehicles parked up in a semicircle. They sure didn't dress like smugglers, the clever bastards. Most of them had glasses on, which was weird, because anybody with 100 skrells could get eye surgery or an implant or something. Maybe it was part of their disguise. Maybe they weren't very good at smuggling and were a bit hard up when it came to cash? Bodega gave it some thought. He couldn't come up with anything. Ah well, 5 minutes till their personal doomsday anyway. What was he, an optician? Bodega checked the action once more on the pivot bipod and instantly thought about vaping. Flav it, he thought, and pulled out his mega vape. He took one huge tug and exhaled, regretting it instantly. The smugglers all looked up towards the 50-meter cubed cloud of vape billowing off the hilltop. One of them fired up an RC drone and buzzed it straight at Bodega. As it neared him, he tensed every muscle in his body, letting out a small fart as he did so. Not out of fear, but as a precaution. A fart in combat is no joke. It can really put you off. But the drone didn't open fire. It hovered nearby, and a small reedy voice emitted from a speaker on the front. Hello, are you the park ranger? We have a permit to fly our drones as long as it's not a Sunday. Furthermore, flav this! His position revealed in his cover blown, Bodega started putting some serious heat downrange. Target one was the Pendejo controlling this thing. The famous Lascan of Bodega did its dreadful business and superheated every molecule of water in that dude's body as he exploded into a trillion fiery fragments. Now it's time for the pivot bipod to do its work. No need to take his finger off the trigger. Bodega simply played the Lascan around the smuggler's meeting point like an old man watering some plants. A drop of water for the Grubles, a dash for the Clearforths, a good soaking for the needy Jup-Jup tree. Although in Bodega's case, this translated into three more smugglers shrieking in agony as they were sliced into bits by the Lascan.
Oh man.
Holy shit.
He took a quick squiz down the sights and noticed that many of the smugglers were crawling around and shrieking. Some had curled up into balls and were crying, and some were more desperately trying to run for cover. Zap! All of them paid the ultimate price for smuggling, which was death by Bodega. Job done. He packed up and headed back towards the Gretham. As he got closer, he noticed a group of men off to the south, close enough to hear their conversation. They wore black stealth suits and each carried a large bore Omni rifle. Hunting season started earlier this year. Bodega gave a cheery wave and a thumbs up. The men looked bemused for a moment before waving back. Bodega climbed into the Gretham and blammed into orbit. Onto his next mission. The end.
Wait, what were they smuggling, though?
Oh, Tips, you didn't get it. They were just flying their drones in the forest.
That was it?
Yes, he killed the wrong people, and then he bumped into the smugglers on the way home.
Oh, shit.
I thought it was obvious. Should I make it more obvious?
It was very obvious.
No, you know what? It was pretty obvious, but I stopped paying attention because I was thinking really hard about what they were smuggling. Sorry.
You were trying to decipher.
I was
the
like
puzzle.
Thinking it because I was like, so the whole time I'm visualizing, right? I'm trying to think about what these guys are smuggling. I realize now that they weren't smuggling, and then, you know, he passed them. But the whole time, I can't get out of my mind how much this reminds me of Gentleman Broncos, you know, like the sci fi part of Gentleman Broncos.
Yeah.
Also, it reminds me a lot of Better Call Saul, you know, when Mike is out in the desert and
I
he's like,
I haven't watched it.
Oh, sorry. That's not a spoiler anyway.
No,
Mike goes into the desert.
No. Mike is in a desert. Point. That's not a surprise.
And he's got a sniper rifle and stuff as well. And it really reminded me of that part of Better Call Saul too. Man, Bodega's really good.
Honestly, P-Flex, that was magnificent.
Tress, are you ready?
Oh, yes.
Get ready. Yeah. Get comfortable.
Hang on. Hold up. Yep, Let me just move the mic down a bit. I'm going to recline a little.
Okay,
this time I'm not going to try to think about other shows while you do. I'm going to actually listen and pay attention. Okay, go.
This is reasonably long compared to previous. It's 2 pages.
Oh man, okay, great.
Holy shit.
Man, you're getting into this. Lewis has got some stiff
Let me
competition.
Just sit comfortably.
All right, you ready?
I'm stiff right now though. Yeah.
Oh, me too.
Bodega, part tres, or tre, I don't know how you
tres.
Say it. Bodega peered once more through the quadnoculars. 5 hours he'd been watching the Pulsar Sex Pit, and the only thing suspicious was that he couldn't find anything wrong. This wasn't right. The pit was a legendary hangout for every lad, slinger, and roid runner in the galaxy. Most of what could loosely be termed his compadres used this very spot to reminisce, catch up, and do business. This time it was different. It was Herc Burke's Burke Day, a very special day for the Burkean people when they celebrated the day they were born. Bodega wondered why, in his experience, humans never celebrated this occasion, but he didn't give a flying crump for it himself. Flarvin, he muttered, firing up the tear cycle and zipping down to the pit. He couldn't pass up the chance to see everybody, even if it did feel suspiciously innocent. Too innocent. Like, way too innocent. 100% chance shit was going down here for that very reason. Guaranteed. 100%. Barking up, he ran a quick mental sit rep. Lascan, cocked and loaded, naturally. Jetpack, ready to rock. Scram boots, pumped to the max. Grabby, spring wound tighter than a Spaloopian's love pouch.
Grabby. Hang on a second. Just read that sentence again. Go through this adventure again. One of the comments I did read, P-Flex, was that you need to like take it a little more slowly so you can digest. Because it's complicated. When you're reading like a sci-fi...
Do you know what? It's so hard to pay attention to the gobbledygook and the actual story.
Okay. It's not gobbledygook. It's lore. Okay. Lascan, cocked and ready, naturally. Jetpack, ready to rock. Scram boots, pumped to the max. Grabby, spring wound tighter than a Spaloopian's love pouch.
Love it.
Shrovian knuckle duster, eager to do business with some chump's speak hole. There were more tricks up his sleeve, but Bodega was reluctant to even think about them till the time came, in case some sneaky empath was trying to get the drop on him. He took a deep breath and banged on the Quintanium door. Farve off, said a voice from the other side. Bodega, said Bodega. A moment passed, then the door sprang open.
Bodega,
said Bodega.
It sounds like the guy in Star Wars, the guy that works at Jabba's palace.
Yes.
Bodega.
The one and only anchor. Yeah. And a gigantic Vicarg was in the frame, grinning like a woodle hound. Sweet Groggle, Bodega, he boomed. Come on in, Pard, not seen you for a whiles. Heh, been busy. Where's the birthday Burke? Down in the pit. And I mean, in the pit, said the Vicarg, grinning even more. If his grin extended any further, he was in danger of losing an ear. Bodega headed down the dank corridor into the lobby, then descended a ramp towards the deafening sound of the pulsar sex pit in full flow. Music with so much bass, it was causing the planet's orbit to decay. Booze so strong, the toilets had to be reinforced with giga shields. And women so betitted, Bodega had to wear... Bodega had to wear a quad betitted.
Jesus! Fuck! Fuck
Bodega
me!
Bodega had to wear a quantanium jockstrap to prevent any inconvenience.
Oh my god.
No man wants to fight with a bone on. Or at least not one that ain't squared away combat style.
It's a bone on an alien race.
No, a bone on. He headed straight for the bar and ordered a pint of Mutant Ale. No sooner had he started talking than... Bodega! Screamed the man over the music, which the DJ promptly stopped. Silence in the pit. All eyes on Bodega. Pushing through the crowd, a huge Burkean approached. Bodega. Been a while. Not seen you since... maybe 2 weeks ago. Been working. Came back to wish you a happy birthday, Herc Burke. Well, Bodega, back in the pit, said Herc Burke, grinning. People sure were smiling a lot, thought Bodega. Too much. Too much smiling. Ain't no call for all this grinning and smiling, it ain't usual. We were hoping you'd come back. Me, Squiddles, Rhombus, Treg, and, you remember this guy, right? A huge man in a yellow jumpsuit stepped forward. Black skull mask and billowing red cape. Bodega couldn't see his face behind the mask, but he knew he'd be smiling like the rest of these humfunkers. Fluff. It was a setup. The man in yellow. It was none other than Tan Blatchman, Bodega's arch nemesis.
Oh my god. Not Tan
Ship
Blatchman.
Is about to get extremely real in this place, and many, many people were about to be separated from the body parts they held most dear. Bodega intended to get out of this in one piece, and if that meant the end of the Pulsar Sex Pit and everybody in it, or even within sight of it, so be it. Bodega knew three things had to happen within the next second, or he'd be toast. First, he had to distract every single person in here who was currently pointing a gun at him. The pit was full, so that was maybe 200 people. No problem. He stamped down on the button in the heel of his right boot, and waves of patented Happy Thoughts brain musher poured out of the toe and blasted everybody within 50 meters. Half of them would end up on the floor drooling. The other half would become deeply acquainted with the inside of their own eyelids and spend the next year singing a song about a little flea named Peter. Second, he needed to nail the people unaffected by the brain musher, which was anyone with half an idea about Bodega and what he was capable of, since they would have taken a dose of brain shield. That meant the five morons who'd set this whole thing up. Last gun holstered and no time to draw it, he needed subplans to point to named B, C, and D. Plan B was to employ the grabby grabber and Herc Burke's nuts, which he did to good effect. The grabby grabby shot out of Bodega's left sleeve and clamped on like a grog limpet, sending Herc Burke to his knees, eyes wide and mouth small. Plan C, Squittles, Rhombus, and Treg all fell to the void grenade Bodega had hidden in a molar tooth and spat into the middle of them, congealing their bodies instantly into one homogeneous lump. Finally, Plan D, deal with Blatchman. No doubt he'd got something disgusting up his sleeve, that cape-wearing, jumpsuit-adorned pendejo shitbird. Bodega figured one thing he wasn't ready for was an old-fashioned punch in the kisser. Scram boots propelling him across the room, he connected with Blatchman's jaw with all the fury of a man invited to a birthday party only to be betrayed.
Wait, was the grabby grab still attached?
No, it just shoots out.
Okay.
And thirdly, the entire bar on its ass, one way or another, Bodega did the decent thing and left. Last gun out, he seared a hole in the ceiling and jetpacked gracefully to a height of 200 meters before hovering, setting wide-angle beam on the last gun and raising the entire plate and everyone in it to the ground. Flarv, he said, pausing for a heartbeat. My tear cycle was parked there. The end. Oh my god.
Shit, so he killed everyone, but he wrecked his bike.
Yeah, forgot about his bike.
Oh, that was fantastic. Shit.
See, the grabby grab, I assumed that it was like attached to something. To
his balls. You don't want to be left there with a grabby grab.
No, but I thought it was like one of those, you know, those like kid robot arm things with the trigger that like makes it pinch sort of thing, but it was like attached to his pants or something.
I'm pretty sure that he could, if needed, fire it out with like a line attached, if he actually had to pull something to him.
Oh, right, and then the line just breaks off,
yeah,
sort of thing.
But he can, yeah. I mean, it's Bodega, you know, he's got a million tricks up his sleeve. One
That's
of them is
true, yeah.
The deployable grabby-grabby that just clamps onto some guy's nuts.
It's pretty nice.
There's 20 minutes at the start about dicks, and we solved Mike. I mean, we solved
the micropenis conundrum as
also,
well.
Also, wait, we haven't, there is something, hold on a second.
Oh,
Bodega part quattro. We have Bodega Part Quattro. If you want, we don't have to do it this week. It's up to you guys.
No, this is the best part
I
for
wait
me.
For this, yeah.
All right.
You know,
enunciate, right. Are you ready?
Be careful.
Okay, enunciate this gentle time, okay?
I will.
Okay, good.
Bodega.
Can we have Ray Winston?
No, my voice won't take it.
Okay.
Bodega Part Quattro. No, we'll do it normally.
Oh, come on.
Bodega Part Quattro. Clouds of exhaust fumes, the stench of synth oil mixed with coolant, and the musky funk of 1,000 space dock engineers. Bodega choked back the aroma of the Baracchian Quanto hub from high up on a gantry. His Gretham shuttle was parked on the roof. Its chameleon stealth field and some fancy flying had made it past the security screens. He rested one hand on his las gun and the other on his groin, which was itching like hell. Damn Spaloopian crotch crabs. 100 meters below.
Not the Spaloopians.
Oh, they're the worst. The busy spaceport on the surface of Quanto 4 looked safe enough. Bodega had been scanning the crowds for an hour now, making sure there wasn't an ambush. That business with the smugglers had drawn some weird heat. Fedpol had been all over him like a case of crotch crabs. He wondered just how high up the remote-controlled vehicle smuggling ring went, but that wasn't his business. What was his business was the stench coming from the toilets on his ship. In orbit, cloaked naturally, its legendary ship, the Disco Volante, waited and, frankly, it reeked. He was pretty sure whatever was causing the noxious stank might even be leaking into space. However badly it ponged, it was still his ship, and at the push of a button on his wrist comp, it would decloak and rocket down to Bodega's position. At the push of another button, the ship would self-destruct, taking anything within 100 clicks with it. Bodega had to make sure he pushed the right button. He didn't know why he'd put the two buttons next to each other, but these things happen. What are you going to do?
Were they like a different color or anything?
With the spaceport surveillance complete,
okay.
Bodega gave his crotch one more good scratch before he jetpacked down to the main floor. Since he wore no cape, the jetpack worked properly. If he'd been wearing a cape, Scrum knows what would have happened. Once down, he collared a Fedorian engineer and demanded a landing berth for his ship. He called the Disco Volante down from orbit by focusing hard and pressing the correct button. The Fedorians were a squat, ugly collection of what Bodega referred to as nerds. They knew everything there was to know about the inner workings of spaceships and computers and nerd shit like that. Loathsome as they were, Bodega had no choice. He'd studied grown-up things like how to tear a man's throat out and how to field strip a Vitarian squirm beam battle pack, so not useful when it came to fixing a busted mega toilet. The crapper needs some work. Got a stink coming off it, worse than Bodega began to explain before the Fedorian interrupted. Its nasal voice cut through Bodega like a las gun through a pack of nerds. Before we even get to the toilets, I really have to question your decision to have only one access door to this vessel. You really should have three. To not even have two is pretty terrible. This thing is already a death trap, and the controls are on the wrong side of the door. They should be on the right, and your gangplank is off angle by about 3 degrees. Bodega grimaced. Fucking nerds, he thought. They entered the ship. I don't smell anything wrong here, said the Fedorian.
It stinks. The toilet. It's broken. Trust me, said Bodega.
It really doesn't, but okay, said the Fedorian, and he made for the toilets. As he entered the main deck of the Disco Volante, he recoiled in horror, pawing at the vid panels and peering into access shafts.
Smell it now, asked Bodega, grinning.
No, it's your setup. My God, you have so many things wrong here. Why is your stealth field not firmware upgraded? Look at this wiring. It's like you don't even care. I have no idea why you would get a ship this expensive if you don't even know how to rig the squig indexer correctly. You must be losing like 1.5% more fuel every time you deorbit. The Fedorian was actually sniggering. He was standing there aboard the legendary Disco Volante and laughing at it.
At Bodega.
Bodega's face hardened.
Are you shitting on my ship?
He asked, giving the Fedorian one last chance to climb down from the precipice of a really bad time. The ship is a good one, but it's the owner. My Groggle, you have absolutely no idea what you're doing here, do you? This thing is suboptimal. It actually makes me want to put my head in my hands and maybe make a big post about it in the Fedorian engineering forums. The engineer prattled on, not noticing Bodega unholstering his famous las gun and aiming it squarely at the Fedorian's head.
Pard, you just cursed your planet a spaceport, said Bodega.
As the Disco Volante sped into orbit, the Gretham following an autopilot behind, the explosions from the Barakian Quanto hub could be seen for miles around. Lasgun scorching, torpedo blasts, and even some dents from a fist would be found by investigators in the weeks to come. Bodega from found the vault with the toilet anyway. He'd been drunk on bum pincher ale and had just forgotten to flush away a particularly unpleasant crap from the previous night. As his ship entered orbit, he flushed. The ship ejected the toxic poop, which tumbled back down to the planet's surface with a hearty plop. A final reminder for the people of this world,
don't fuck with Bodega.
Oh my god. Oh my god, okay.
Oh, I like the crap in here.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Okay, do you want my storytelling adjunct
go
to
for
the
it,
end?
Go
I think
for it.
I think what you needed to do was grab the flav by the scruff of his neck. The nerd, sorry, by the scruff of his neck. Get his head down there. Fucking get it in the toilet.
What did you say to Sips? What did you say to Sips last week?
What did I say to Sips?
He tried to correct me and say what you should have done, and you said you can't tell Pyrian what to do. He's an artist.
Oh, shit. So anyway, do your Bodega. Let's fucking get in there. Let's enjoy it.
Yeah. I don't feel like you're in the right frame of mind for a Bodega.
Ben said about Bodega. He said, "Thing I like about Bodega is that it's taking the piss out of all the shit science fiction.
Exactly.
But then it's become its own thing.
Yeah. Who knew?
It's grown beyond it." To the point where it's a little bit like pandas in World of Warcraft, okay? It started off...
I knew World of Warcraft would fucking come up at some point. Jesus.
It started off being the joke, but now it's coming to a whole expansion.
I haven't been playing it at all recently.
And there's going to be like a Bodega book, and it's going to become a real thing.
But anyway. Bodega, part 5.
Oh,
this is very different from other Bodegas, this one, okay?
Okay, I mean, in a bad way?
You'll see.
All right.
Scratching the itchy collar of his dull gray uniform, Ensign Crunkett waited impatiently outside Commander Tortola's quarters. He'd made an appointment to see Tortola 3 days ago. How the scriv can the boss man be so busy? They'd been sat in this asteroid belt on silent running for 3 months with no orders that he knew of. What a waste of time. 3 months jammed into every crevice of this fast patrol ship, except for the areas that were mysteriously off-limits. That meant no trips to engineering to hang out with his buddy Looper. Definitely no trips to the cargo hold, which was normally a good vape spot. 3 months manning his listening post and hearing nothing. It was space. It was generally pretty flarving quiet. Startling Crunkett, the intercom to Tortola's room barked, "Enter!" And the door hissed open. Crunkett stooped to enter the commander's quarters. They were cramped, yet the designers had still found room to cram a desk in here along with a bed, a bathroom, and a lounge, all in dull official grey. That was the colour of most things around here, official grey. Tortola was sat in his grey uniform and his grey chair behind the grey desk, staring at his computer screen. He made a condescending hand gesture to Crunkett to begin talking. Crunkett cleared his throat. "Sir, it's been 3 months. I was due some R&R 2 weeks ago, but because we're stuck here, I missed the birth of my daughter, and I'm thinking..." Tortola cut him off with a glance. He read from the screen. "Crunkett. Ensign Crunkett. 2 years service on the force. And here you are marching into my quarters to demand leave. We're on a mission. You don't need to know what that mission is, Ensign, but by Groggle, we're on it. You signed over your right to a holiday when you took the oath and put on a badge," said Tortola. "A rehearsed dressing down was on its way," Crunkett guessed. Tortola stood up sharply in an attempt to look authoritative, but banged his head on the low ceiling. Pretending this hadn't happened, he continued. lecturing Crunkett about duty and the importance of the Morality Police Division out here in the void of space. How beings could lose their sense of direction and decency and needed to know that out here in the blackness there was still an organization dedicated to rooting out wrong and bringing justice to the unjust. Just because space is cold and uncaring doesn't mean we have to be. Sir, I've worked law enforcement before. I've done stakeouts before. This feels like a stakeout, but we're staking out an asteroid belt in the arse end of nowhere. Nobody comes here because these rocks are empty. There are no habitable planets. There is no traffic. There's nothing. If I'd known this was going to be the mission, I never would have signed up for it, pleaded Crunkett. I thought we were going to be back in time for my wife's due date. This is the SS Expectation, Ensign, said Tortola, gesturing around him. We're not your usual police cruiser. There's a reason we didn't tell any of you what your mission was. You're getting paid time and a half, so you're being compensated appropriately. I'm not going to ask you to trust me, because this is not about trust. This is about duty. Do your job. Get out of my office, said Tortola coldly. Crunkett left. He wasn't angry. The worker man always got screwed over like this. He was resigned to it. He just wanted to make sure his daughter had better. Crunkett was in the middle of wondering what he was going to do when the red lighting pulsing in the floor and at every comm station told him that the silent alarm had been tripped. He ran to his post, jostling with other members of the crew doing the same. Part of him was nervous. Another part thought, thank Flav, something to do. Tortola was on the bridge in a heartbeat after everyone else. He addressed the crew. Okay, people, it's time to come clean. We've just detected the vessel we were sent to find. We're just one of hundreds of ships just like ours undertaking the same mission all over the galaxy. For 3 months we've been laying in wait like Tredorian trap crabs. And now, finally, we've detected the ship. It's docking at a hidden base on an asteroid in the Borkaba belt, just a few hundred thousand clicks ahead of us. It is vital that we maintain silent running. Ensign Crunkett, go to work. Crunkett slid into his seat and rummaged for his headset. The chatter on the bridge was reaching fever pitch. Everybody was thinking the same thing. Holy shit, something's actually happening. Something's happening, but what? The listening post was incredibly high-tech. He used an almost undetectable array of ultra-fine beams of varying compositions to scan a huge area of space and detect micro-distortions caused by sound waves. In space, of course, there was no sound, but the beam array carried enough different types and layers that even the most well-shielded surface could be probed, and you could listen in to anything pressurized, even a space helmet. And once something was detected, the array could narrow down to that point and listen into anything. The sound of weapons being charged, an ultra-quiet engine, even a conversation, or what Crunkett heard, a man whistling a jaunty tune. He recognized the tune. It was Ode to the Lasgun, a famous war song from Shrovia, the planet of war. Shrovians? Out here in deep space? They normally stuck to their factories and boardrooms, coming up with new and terrible weaponry. Then he heard talking, someone recording a personal log. And when he heard the voice, his blood froze in his veins and he felt tears welling in his eyes. This was the dread fear that consumed all hope in a man. Sir, he mumbled. Crunkett, speak, man. Sir, I think it's Bodega. Tortola stood slowly, steeling himself. Ensign Zither, send the whisper, said Tortola. And the tiny scout vessel of the MPD fired a single subspace particle from its comms array. That single particle would be lost in the background noise of the universe to anyone listening. Impossible to decrypt, impossible to detect. Bodega could not know that the MPD vessel Expectation just sent a one-bit signal. That MPD HQ would instantly know meant one thing. Operation Kill Bodega was on.
Bodega. Oh, amazing. So, okay, couple of things. First of all, I like how it's good shit sci-fi because it's the same shit we're familiar with, yet massively far in the future. It's right, like, right. You know, you've got an ensign and a grumpy guy and like a military boardroom and all that shit and vaping in like a, you know. And do you know what I mean? It's like Ensign Crunkett is totally the Mary Sue of Perian Flax. You know, you are. If you put yourself into this universe, you would be.
I wouldn't be Ensign Crunkett.
You're totally Ensign Crunkett. There's so much Mary Sueing going on.
I'm Bodega. Like, come on.
No, you're not. You're Ensign Crunkett.
I'm a cold,
like,
hard killer.
Like the hard, dumb boy, like guy who's like pretty low rank. He's like a bit sick of it. He's had to miss his story.
I wouldn't even be in the police, man. I wouldn't sign up with the Popo. Come 100% on.
That. And I like this because by the time something gets to like part five, right, it's got a bit bad, right? and they start doing things like introducing new characters. No, because everyone says, I just wanna have a bodega adventure. But the author's like, oh, I'm a bit sick of writing bodega adventures. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna add some new characters. So he adds Ensign Crunk and he adds this new guy, and everyone's like, oh, well, it's not the bodega I remember, but at least it's not a bodega.
Bodega wasn't even in this episode, really.
Yeah, and that's what starts happening when they start getting to like these, you know, later stage sequels and stuff.
As a counterpoint, Flax, I thought it was fucking great.
Like a big furry ball sack.
Like two big hairy testicles, one of which has teeth.
Like gremlins before they become like the gross ones.
Right,
like
right.
The little,
but yeah, huge Furbies. And furious.
Little
yeah.
Furbies, yeah. A huge, okay. Furious Furby.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. If you can hook me up with all that, that would be awesome.
Okay.
Then I can, yeah. All right, let's hear for Bodega part six.
Seis.
Part six.
Seis. Seis.
Are you ready?
Drum roll. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Bodega.
Fucking born ready.
Part six. Huffing and puffing like an old-timey steam engine, Benny the orderly wheeled Bodega out onto the veranda overlooking the grounds of the prison on Pentar 9. He set the brake on the wheelchair and leant against the railings, catching his breath. Pushing this thing around was hell on his back. Phew! Okay, old-timer, here we are. Now, what are we looking for? Said Benny. Bodega wheezed alongside Benny.
There's a star I'm looking for, croaked the ancient convict.
A star for your 300th birthday, huh? Said Benny, kneeling beside him and peering up. He glanced at Bodega, whose face was knotted with concentration.
Can't see nothing, he said finally, before turning his head slowly to Benny. His eyes still had that bodega sparkle, but he also smelled badly of urine, so it balanced out.
I love this so much
well,
already.
Well, let's head on down, old-timer. They'll be bringing out your cake soon, said Benny, as he stood and began fiddling with the brake lever on the chair. As the wheels pivoted to take them back to the elevator, Bodega took one last glance at the constellations above. There, a bright blue star, brighter than a lasgun beam. It had no place where it was, right in that area of space known as the Dark Rift, a vast area totally devoid of matter. Some said there'd been once thousands of stars and hundreds of worlds in that gap before some insane and ancient mega war had emptied the corner of the galaxy. And now there was a star. Bodega turned to Benny.
Benny, that star there, you see it?
Benny looked. Yeah, yeah, I see it, man, I see it.
You know what that star means? Said Bodega, smiling.
Why don't you tell me, pard?
It means
something, said Bodega, looking lost in the thick fog of age. Downstairs at the party, Benny left Bodega at one end of a long table while he went to get the cake. There were no guests. There was a single paper plate and a plastic fork, a napkin, a plastic cup of water. Bodega was held into the wheelchair with metal restraints at his wrists, elbows, knees, ankles, neck, and around his waist. Benny would have to feed him the cake. Benny was great. Benny was a real star.
Real star, said Bodega.
Then he froze. He looked at the plate, at his hands, at the fork. Then he closed his eyes. Benny re-entered the room, just in time for it to explode into a million bright white shards of light, along with Benny. Bodega was lying in what looked like a stasis pod. He was restrained in reality, just like he was in that illusory sim world he'd been stuck in. For how long? How long had he been under? He was as naked as a Quardian. A people known for being naked, and not just naked, but really in your face, think nothing of it, bending down to pick up a penny and giving you an eyeful, naked. He focused hard on that corner of his brain where the implant was, the minute implant that had maybe saved his life. That implant was inserted into his brain a decade ago by his then girlfriend, Majesta. She was a psychic being of nearly limitless power who'd looked into his soul one day and decided that actually it wasn't her, it was him, and they should break up. She took his dog, convincing it telepathically that she would be the better owner. That was the real heartbreaker, thought Bodega.
Oh my god,
what a bitch.
Anyway, the implant was her idea. He remembered her words. Bodega, my love, I've given you a part of my power. I've hidden it in your mind, buried deep in the corner you never use. Just next to your pity and your mercy, you'll find me. If you're ever lost in the darkness, if your mind is not your own, look for me, your bright blue star in the void. That implant did more than send him a signal. It was also one of the most perfect prison escape packages ever devised. It was the high-tech equivalent of the old file hidden in a cake trick. He needed to crush the implant with his actual brain. He had to use every muscle and sinew in his brain to crush the implant and release its power. Come on, you fucker, pop, thought Bodega.
And with titanic effort, pop, it did. He saw stars. Then he saw waves of energy all around him, knowing their composition and their purpose, their origin and their future all at once. While the effects of the implant were in full force, he was at one with the universe. He could shape matter, move through it, bend it to his will. He melded right up out of the pod, hanging in the air like some deity. An orderly working the night shift dropped his cup of synth tea and ran out of the room screaming. Bodega didn't have long before the effects of the implant wore off. He could sense his ship about 200 meters below him, and he pivoted in the air and dived straight down through the decks of the station. He realized he was now on. He could sense all the panic. He could see the past and future of every particle and every living person nearby, and he could feel their emotions and their thoughts. It was overwhelming. He focused on the one thing he needed, the Disco Volante. In a moment, he was there, floating in its lounge area. He rematerialized and quickly put on a spare spacesuit. Firing up the engines, he focused one more time and deleted the cargo bay doors from existence. The ship was blown out into space, along with dozens of dock workers. He fired up the engines and plotted a course for somewhere far away, and slammed the hyperspace button with his palm. The Disco Volante hung motionless for a moment, before it became a single streak of light, pointing straight into the void. The end.
Bodega. Wow.
Oh,
Bodega.
Bodega. God, that was a glorious Bodega.
That was a really good one.
Thank you. So we missed out. Like, I leave all these gaps because I can go back and fill them in later, and also because people like to write all this fan fiction and stuff. So I want to leave all these gaps. Like the Trial of Bodega, that has to happen now. What happened at the Trial of Bodega? Yeah. How did he end up on Prison Planet? I mean, we know that there was that operation in the last one to capture him, but why didn't they
filling in the blanks is fun though. You can do, you know, you can do like the what they're doing with Star Wars, you know,
exactly.
Like the new movie. You can just have like little side
It's just
stories.
Like Star Wars. It's just
Bodega
like...
stories.
Buenos Aires. How do you say it? How are you supposed to say it?
I think
Buenos Aires. Buenos Aires.
You have to have a little bit of a lisp as well.
Buenos Aires.
And then you have to have a little bit of a silence, and then in your angriest voice, you have to say puta.
All right.
Okay.
Puta.
Good.
Puta. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So, Bodega Part 7. Would you like to hear it?
Let's do it.
Yeah. Let me recline. Hang on.
Yeah.
Hang on. I'm a little bit tangled up here. Wires. And
press the back of your chair to get it in a more comfortable
position.
Nice.
I've got my legs up and everything.
Okay.
All right. Ready.
Ready.
Yeah, I guess.
So wait, hang on. What happened last time? Because it's been a little while.
I'll give you a little recap. In
the last one
six,
was the prison.
He was in the mind prison. Yeah, the virtual mind prison.
That's right.
Escaped by channeling that little piece of Majesta that was embedded in his brain. Former girlfriend Majesta.
Majesta.
And so he'd used that to turn into a kind of ethereal being like her, and had escaped. So now, Bodega Part 7. Majesta! Bodega screamed himself awake for the fourth night in a row. He reached his hand slowly to his face and yet again felt tears there. Was he sleep crying? Sweet jumping jub-jub, this was not usual. He dragged the heavy blast-proof sheets back and sat on the edge of the bed, head in hands.
Blast-proof sheets?
Of course!
Oh my god!
Pondering. When he'd escaped the virtual prison, see episode 6, he'd been forced to deploy the shard of Majesta's power that lay in his mind, which to that point had been dormant, or so he'd assumed. Now it was gone, consumed by his transformation into whatever Majesta was. He probably should have found out the name for her people when they were together, but frankly, that time had been bone central. Every day, all day, just getting busy like Krevians and screaming around the galaxy in the Disco Volante, screwing and shooting stuff sometimes. In short, it fucking owned, and Bodega missed it. He remembered the time they'd taken the crooked casino on Bismuth 11 for all its coin. The time they'd busted those rebel prisoners out of Highsec using just a drinking straw and some chapstick. The time they'd destroyed an entire solar system with the doom egg of the Death Lord, Mr. Pringle. Now that was a long story. Good times. So many good times. And of course, the constant shagging, which was really, really, really good. Just incredible. He was getting a semi just thinking about it. Turns out, Bodega missed Majesta. That little shard of her maybe kept that longing at bay. Maybe she was even kind of with him all this time, though hopefully not when he was on the can or jerking it to Spaloopian porn. He looked at the floor and saw tiny pools of tears reflecting the light from the cockpit. In the reflection of one, he saw something move. Just a teeny tiny little reflection of something to his right. Bodega's reflexes being what they are, i.e. honed to flav, he dived backwards over the bed and was up and ready in a heartbeat, lasgun in hand. His captors had been too worried about the Disco Volante's many booby traps to ever board it and strip it, so all his shit was secure. "I see ya," Bodega shouted, "and I ain't in the mood for this mort crap." "Bodega," said a voice, a jester's voice. He fell apart, laid out completely, a TKO of the heart. Baby, I'm hurting," he whimpered. "I know. I'm sorry, my love," she said. He still couldn't see her, just sort of sense her loitering around the edges of his subconscious. And then she was gone. Then suddenly she was back, behind him, to the side, then what felt like a mile away. What the flav? Was she just fooling with his achy breaky heart? "Bodega, I need you to meet me," she said again, her voice distant and ethereal. "Where, baby, where? I got a subscription to Netflarv so we can chill and such like."
Oh my god.
"Come to the planet Stroyan 9, at the base of the highest peak on that world, and you'll find my estate. I'll be waiting." The engines of the Disco Volante were at maximum burn before the full stop on the end of that sentence had faded. It was 12 hours to the destroyer system. Bodega did it in 3. He spiraled down through the thick upper atmosphere, his ship roaring across the sky, engines swirling the clouds behind him. High-altitude hoverbirds and strange floating gas bag creatures scrambled clear, but Bodega plowed on, disturbing this tranquil place with the brutality of the warship. He practically collided with the estate in his haste, but then the ship was down. He emergency ejected out of the top and parkoured down across the nose cone. Then he was up and he was running to the gates, vaulting over them with his jetpack, powering with his scram boots to the front door, grabbing the whole flaving thing off its hinges, and knee sliding across the marble floor, stopping at Majesta's feet, his head bowed. Jesus. "Baby, he began as he looked up and saw Majesta holding a tiny baby swaddled in a Mimlock silk blanket. He stood slowly, removing his hat. "What's this little feller's name?" he asked gently. "I named him after his father," said Majesta, smiling. "Why, hello there, little Bodega Jr.," said Bodega, smiling. He felt something in his heart go twang, like an old guitar string that badly needed tuning. This was an unfamiliar sensation. It was the pure love of a parent for their child. He looked at Majesta, but her expression was strange. Her perfect brow knotted, her lips parted. "No, Bodega, after his father," she said. "This is Tan Blatchman Jr." And with that sentence, Bodega's universe imploded. The end.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. Hey.
Oh no.
So, two things, okay? Yeah. In this world of crazy sort of like lingo for things.
Right.
Jerking it, I felt, could have been something else. You know, like jerking it. Like, you know, what about like thwarving it or something, you know?
Yeah, but
like
you wouldn't
instead
know what that meant. You know what jerking it means. Like, there are some things that never change. Even when you're out in the galaxy and everything's all crazy and there's all kinds of weird animals and stuff, swear words might change, just like they do in real life and stuff. But jerking it is jerking it. That's it. That ain't never going to change.
Also, I'm a little bit sort of with the Majesta shard, okay?
Yeah.
I feel like it's in Bodega.
It was.
It was.
Yeah.
Maybe corrupting him a little bit while it's in there. And man, I am not on board for a story of corruption and fell, okay?
What I'm do you mean saying. Corruption? He ain't corrupted.
Okay, good. Let's just make, I just want to be clear that like,
wait, you think Majesta's, the implant would have made him evil?
No, not evil, just somehow corrupted him to do things that maybe he wouldn't have done.
It was just an escape, it was a prison escape kit embedded in his brain, remember?
Okay, okay.
It's like, that when
no,
when
I know
he
that's what he used it for, but I just wanted to make sure that like,
fear not.
It was like a special one-off.
Yeah.
That,
fear not.
You know,
okay.
It was a one-shot, it was a one-shot escape plan.
Like the file in the carrot cake.
Exactly. It was like that.
Yeah. Exactly. Man, P-Flex, this was
a good one.
Charged.
It's really good.
It felt like I was reading a little bit of a sexy girl
porn. Oh yeah, you know it.
Mills and Boone, you know, the classic thing that girls love to read about love and romance.
I feel like the
romance
character development is really coming together. Like, big time.
Yeah. Man, hearing him do like speak a bit more is also
he doesn't talk much.
No.
Loved it. Yeah. Was transfixed the whole time.
Oh,
that
good.
Was. I think you've outdone yourself.
Oh,
actually,
thank you,
P-Flex. This was
one of the better ones.
One of the best. I've got no gripes.
Oh,
I loved
it.
Start to finish.
Wow, good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
got a big old raging boner now.
Whoa,
loving it.
Nice.
Yeah. I think it's time to end the episode then, in that case, because I've got to deal with this.
Yeah, it's got a lot of emotions to sift through now.
All right, guys, can we stop for about 15 minutes? Yep, see you in a bit. Yep.
I only need like 2 minutes.
Guys, let's go. I spilled Coke all over my pants. I just got to go wipe it out.
We lived in a broken world. It was a broken world. And everything was closed. Shit was closed all the fucking time. Nowadays, everything's open.
You'd turn up, you'd be like, I need to get something. You go to the store. It's closed down?
Yeah.
What?
It's closed.
When? Yeah. Just gone.
That actually did happen a lot, yeah. Maybe that was just the ravages of time, though.
Maybe.
That was like, oh, it was 10 years since I visited this
time. Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
holy
shit.
So do we have a bodega?
Bodega part ocho.
Oh, we do.
Ocho. Yeah, we do.
I like that.
Yeah. Are you ready?
What's nine for nientes?
Nueno. So
nine-o.
Translate from English.
Right.
Nueve.
There is a... Nueve. I just looked up bodega t-shirt. You actually have to type in bodega t-shirt.
Yeah.
Yogscast.
Okay,
because otherwise
you
get loads of... others, yeah, like this Bodega Bay place. Apparently, that's a big place.
Get
I don't know.
I love it. I'm very, very happy with it. And if you want to just send us cash money, please do that. That's fine. Just send
hell yeah, in an envelope, all crinkled up. Yeah.
Me and Sips are fine, but P-Flax shopping list has got like five kids and like your cousins and brothers and grands and everything, and you know,
I need
it's a
help,
mess.
Folks, I need help.
Everyone's begging for cash. You know, have to stop writing letters to people because you can't afford the phone.
Oh dear, yeah.
Your dear mom Floppy, she hasn't had heat for a year. You desperately need some money.
Biff
turn
and
that
have
heat
nothing.
Back on.
They have nothing.
Biff,
Biff
and
has
Chip
a
starving.
Pot. Chip has a mop. That's all.
Now read it. It'll be a test tomorrow.
Okay. Bodega.
Let's go.
Part ocho. When Bodega got really upset, there were three likely outcomes. Option one, go blow up the nearest big thing. Could be a pirate base, could be a veterans hospital. Didn't matter. Something is getting vaporized. Generally speaking, he went after baddies, like a veterans hospital for soldiers that had become veterans by slaughtering innocent people. Imagine a retirement home for space Nazis. It's still a veterans hospital, and it's still full of the shuffling elderly, but come on, flav those guys. Option two, get blind drunk and crash his ship into something large. Then hop out, argue about quantum insurance with whichever moron confronted him, and then blow the whole place up. Option three, sit on a rock. Bodega was sat on a rock. The universe breathed a collective sigh of relief. The rock sitting option was the one reserved for when Bodega wasn't just upset in a regular way, but in a really baffling, how the flav did that happen way. For when he needed time to get his head around the problem. This rock was on a tiny planetoid called Mu, in the mostly uncharted BV-332 Delta system. Bodega liked this spot because the view was so insane it took his mind off his troubles. And it also had a really bizarre atmosphere that was alcoholic, around 6% proof. You could just sit here and breathe and get nicely loaded and check out the overhead vista of four galaxies colliding. The sky on the dark side of BV-332 Delta Mu was ablaze with billions of stars battling each other for supremacy and generally exploding or dragging each other's guts all over the darn sky. This was what gravity was designed to do. Pull things to shreds, take the beautiful and render it down to its component atoms. It took the free and the liberated and made them its slave. Bodega could feel the atoms of his own body and hoped that one day soon someone would spread them around the galaxy so he couldn't feel this pain anymore. It was his brain atoms that were currently giving him the most pain. He toyed with his las gun, running a finger over the muzzle brake at the end of the barrel. Would he even feel it? He tossed the las gun to one side. Life went on. Surely life went on. Even when your gal has partnered up with one of the largest anuses in the known universe. Tan flarving Blatchman. First of all, how the scrith had that mongol clogger not died at the Pulsar Sex Pit self-defense massacre? This was Blatchman we're talking about, and he is a canny bastard, but still, that place was leveled fairly convincingly. Bodega was glad Blatchman was alive. It meant he could kill him, and properly this time, by hand, one hand, and by the balls. Killing a man with one hand and applying lethal force via the balls only was something Bodega reserved for real, actual bastards like Blatchman. He called the technique the Way of the Exploding Plums. It was taught only in the most prestigious dojos by the most adept grand masters of hand-to-groin combat. He'd taken out a patent and everything. Every time someone used the Way of the Exploding Plums technique, he got a small royalty payment. It was a nice little earner. Just as he was flexing his right hand and grinning in anticipation of feeling Tan Blatchman's naked scrotum nestled in his palm, two things occurred to him. Firstly, that was the single most homoerotic thought Bodega had ever had. And secondly, that it might really upset Majesta if he were to do this. These were followed by a third quick follow-up thought, which was, flav that bitch. He couldn't bring himself to hurt her directly, but flav her and flav that mewling Blatchmanite she called a child. Hey mister, something wrong? Asked a small voice to his left. Bodega turned slowly to see a small pink creature shaped, and if this wasn't proof of a crazy god at the heart of all things, then nothing was, like a dildo. It was a dildonian. A people shunned through necessity by
dildonian.
A people shunned through necessity by all vagina having life forms. The Dildonians were one of the few races denied any kind of place in the Universal Accord. No seat at a high table, no presence on any council. They were one of the forgotten peoples, and it had to be that way, for their own protection, for one thing. What kind of sex slaves would people turn them into? And what kind of conversation would any vagina-having species be able to carry on with a talking dildo?
Howdy, pard. Not seen one of you little fellers in a while, sighed Bodega.
Heh, nothing new there. I spend most of my time hanging out around here in my tiny hermit cave. You know how it is, of course. Apparently, we really, really resemble something called a dildo to most people in the universe, rambled the creature. And stranger still, we even call ourselves Dildonians.
Yep, probably one of them infinite universe things, said Bodega, rubbing his stubble.
You thinking of trying the hermit business? Chirped the Dildonian. It ain't a fun one, but it's kind of satisfying to make it on your own.
I think on my own is something I'm going to be for the foreseeable, said Bodega, squinting at the horizon. But I ain't the hermit kind. Too restless.
The small creature looked sheepish, or as sheepish as a 12-inch erect phallus can.
Fucking dildo. That's fucking amazing.
It cleared its throat. Do you have a vagina? It asked.
No, friend. I'm one of them dick-havers, smiled Bodega.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm gonna go back to my cave.
That's gonna be my icebreaker.
Do you have a vagina?
Nice chatting to you. Good luck, said the Dildonian. Bodega touched the brim of his hat and nodded once. Scriv, things could be worse. He turned his head up once more to the cluster flav of stars in the slow death churn and took a good hard tug on his mega vape. He wasn't going to take revenge on Majesta. He would kill Blatchman if the opportunity arose, but if he chased him down and killed him, it'd be no better than smashing galaxies together. All that would be left would be a colossal black hole. Bodega settled on something else. He decided right then that he was going to start a small business. The end.
Okay.
Nice.
Oh, man. That I can't legit, wait to find out what that is. That cameo from that guy. Oh, my God. That was just amazing. Loved it.
Fucking
Can we get a Dildonian t-shirt, do you think? Probably not.
I think on the Dildonian t-shirt, it should be a picture of a Dildonian looking very happy, and then with the speech bubble that says, do you have a vagina?
That should be the new thing rather than I have a small dick. It should be
Do you have a vagina? It has to be a bit sheepish, so you have to be Do you have a vagina?
Yeah, I like that.
Hey, who wants to hear what? Bodega Part Nueve?
Oh man.
Oh cool.
I do actually.
If you don't want to, that's fine. But if you'd like to.
Is it a New Year's special? Is it Christmas special?
No, it's not themed in any way.
Fuck, I do want to say.
Does Bodega have any New Year's resolutions himself?
Fuck no, dude.
No.
I'm a little bit sick of the Sherlock and Doctor Who and all these things being done as like Christmas sort of specials now. I'm a little bit...
Yeah, it sucks.
Two people died in EastEnders over the Christmas break as well. Did you hear about
was
that?
Was Phil Mitchell one of them?
No. He's due to die soon, apparently, but no. Gotta be big.
They have to keep upping themselves though too, right? They have to be like, okay, this has to be more explosive than last time. We have to kill more people. It has to be more dramatic. It's like Game of Thrones, right? They have to, every season, they have to up the body count. So they're like,
we've detected the next nuclear warhead underneath Walford. Where do we go?
It didn't survive the Y2K.
Compliant.
It's got a Y2K bug in it. Phil Mitchell reveals I've done a bit of Fortran programming in my time. Point,
like, rolls back.
Phil Mitchell's a Fortran consultant.
Oh, don't worry.
From the 80s.
Phil, save us. Hold on, love. I'm debugging. Fucking hell.
I'm debugging. Oh, fuck.
Oh, shit. Anyway, let's do Bodega, right, and let's get
okay
out of here.
Bodega part nueve. All right. Now, nueve, if you remember, in part ocho, he was on the planet with the Dildonian. And at the end of that episode, he decided he was going to start a small business. Okay, so that's the pitch for Part Nueve. A small red light blinked on, and the intercom atop the desk.
Wait, hang on. You got to do the intro, though. You got to go, Bodega.
Sorry.
Bodega, Part Nueve.
Small red light blinked on, and the intercom atop the desk of Sheila Bam barked,
Florence! Infernal thing! What in the crackles? Florf!
From the next room, a voice shouted, Sheila, could you get me a pile of them R580V Cronkite text forms, please? Sheila smiled and rose, shuffling towards the filing cabinets in the corner. She quickly located the R580Vs and took them through to Bodega's office. Here you are, darling, she said, setting them on his cluttered desk.
Shoot, I can't get this gork damn intercom to do a flarvin thing. I'll just set the hollering if and I need you next time, said Bodega, scowling at the small smoking intercom unit, a thin zip blade embedded in its face.
He'd wanted one of these since it seemed like a thing people had in offices. It made the office look more office.
It's very 80s.
Very 80s. It was garbage. Total waste of Skrells. Sheila smiled and turned to leave. Working for Bodega was challenging. He loved technology, but also hated it. He was lovable, but also a terrifying and heavily armed killer on the run from the feds. But it was steady pay and had good dental coverage, so Sheila was happy. Her teeth were a mess. As she was leaving his office, she noticed Bodega had written some names on a whiteboard on the wall. You got the numbers for all that lot, or do you need me to get the Galactic Interlocatron out? Most of these fellas ain't had contact details for years. Gonna need the old GI for this one, yep, said Bodega, leaning back in his chair and putting his feet up. And how about some scoffy? Scoffy was short for Space Coffee, a name so stupid even Bodega balked at using it. But Scoffy was great. He felt like a real office person when he put his feet up on his desk and asked for his secretary to get him a cup of Scoffy. She knew how he took it too. Scream and two scruggers. The ideal color for a cup of coffee was, in Bodega's opinion, perfect tan.
Nice.
And to ensure Sheila knew this exact shade, he'd taped a photo of the ideal cup of scoffy next to the scoffy machine. He also had a tiny surveillance camera that fed straight into his computer terminal so he could watch her while she brewed it, to ensure there was no poisoning, mussing, nor fooling going on with his beverage.
Right.
Nice.
About 10 minutes later, just as the scoffy was kicking in, a notification popped up on Bodega's screen. Sheila performance review, it said. Florv, time to let Sheila know how she was doing and such. This was what management was all about, he guessed. Sheila, he shouted. A moment later, she entered his office. Sit your butt down, Sheila, said Bodega, trying to look kind of official. There was a long silence. You're doing great. Now get me a scoffy, he said. She smiled and left his office. Bodega clicked complete on the pop-up, and that was that. Easy. Bodega, I've got some contact information for those people on your list, shouted Sheila. Send it through, he bellowed. Okay, she hollered. In it came, reams of information about the 9 people on Bodega's get list. Gork bless the Interlocatron. The Galactic Interlocatron was a vast listening device and database. It grabbed every unscrambled signal, unencrypted message, phone conversation, or any other form of communication and stored it. Even casual real-life person-to-person chats in a public place were likely to be overheard by some kind of listening device and duly recorded in the GI database. Of course, access to anyone other than super high-level federal types was forbidden, but Bodega had lived his life by the simple credo, forbidden is for Bodega. Now he needed to get in contact with those bastards and find out if they were interested in his project. They would be. After all, how could they turn this down? The chance to form the 10 most bastardy bastards into one mess of murder and carnage and just do shit. Flav. That was the problem. He knew they had to have a big idea beyond just do shit, but it wasn't coming to him. How could he go out and pitch do shit to 9 people like him? It needed a hook. Sheila, could you come in here? Sheila, of course, obliged. Sheila,
What in the floor is this all about to you? What's the point of it all? Asked Bodega, tipping his hat back so he could see her face real good. Well, you just have to try to do right by people around you and try not to leave behind more of a mess than already was there when you arrived. And just enjoy life, she said sweetly. No, I mean, well, we ain't getting those folks together to throw a darn baby shower or help some old people fix their plumbing. We're up to no good, see, he said. Well, honestly, I thought you were planning on overthrowing the Federation, and I just thought, well, why not? That's a pretty tall order, missy. I ain't one for rebel causes. I just want folks to leave me alone, said Bodega. Well, what if it was a sort of Bodega-style Federation, like your own version, she said. Bodega contemplated this idea. Too much paperwork, he said, eyeballing the already mountainous pile in his in-tray and imagining that scaled up to running a galaxy. No, I just meant the shooting part, she said. Bodega grinned. Now that I can get aboard with, missy, said Bodega, turning his chair towards the viewport and gazing out at the asteroid field they were concealed in. Yeah, this could work. His own version of the Federal Morality Police Division, the humfunkers who'd locked him up in that mindfuck of a prison a few months back. A group of people who folks could turn to for justice when those who were meant to be just were being unjust or just kinda dicks. I'll call it Bodega's Space Rescue Force of People He Knows. Sheila winced. We'll brainstorm it, Sheila, all right? The end.
I like the vibe, the whole 80s small
Bodega's
business.
Bodega's idea of what a business would be like.
Yeah.
I like it a lot.
It is. It's a very 80s vibe to Bodega's business ideas.
It's a little bit noir, isn't it? So a little bit of a dirty detective's office.
But not so much a detective, but more a Bodega's space force of people he kind of knows.
I feel like this episode has been a very important bridging episode.
It is
like,
an important bridging
episode. I think people might listen to it and be like, that was a really bad episode, but... Similar to The Empire Strikes Back, years later they'll look back and they'll realize how important the episode
we
actually
needed,
was.
They'll realize
to build up the rest of the story.
And how important all of those little details were, you know.
I just wanted to see Bodega in an office. That was it.
No, I think it was good, man. It was just as good as all the other ones.
You said
Sheila
it was a bad
well.
Episode.
No, I think that like I don't personally
I
think it was bad.
I respect
but
the,
I think that I think know. That people maybe now expect a lot of action every
episode.
Oh, no,
you can't have action every episode.
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying the pacing is perfect for me.
Yeah, you got to slow it down.
I like how it slowly unfolds.
Because now we need to go out into the galaxy and make contact with the baddest bunch of bastards you've ever met. None of them will be as good a shot, obviously, but they all have skills.
Sometimes you need an episode to lay out the framework of the rest of the journey, right?
And now I've got to come up with nine other characters that are kind of like Bodega, but each have their own set of skills. That is going to be fun. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, that's going to be great. I mean, like the cocaine in Colombia just sort of by the end of the 90s is just like...
It's ridiculous, right?
You love that whole thing. That's a big... You're big into
it's
that.
Completely sort of... They got it. Like, and then sort of
you're
like all the cocaine production...
Like the gangsters,
like
the mafia, the family,
all that
stuff. That's your jam. All right, let's do Bodega and let's get it out of here.
Because I'm a gangster IRL, that's why.
Okay, yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Real gangster.
Bodega, part DF. In the palace of the self-appointed King Wabu, there was a small cupboard beneath a grand staircase. Inside that cupboard, a bulky humanoid form stood silent and still. It was sleek, like a Horvathian air leopard. Its outer skin was dark charcoal grey, and so matte it seemed to reflect almost no light at all. Its head was a simple, slightly tapered oblong with no protuberances or markings, a monolith of efficiency housing some of the most advanced sensors ever created by the Shrovian labs. Its body looked like someone had taken a human being and replaced the limbs with bits of old weaponry. The arms surely belonged to some battlecruiser turret or shoulder-mounted blast cannon. Its legs seemed to be the bones of some ancient war machine found dormant on a dusty world. Its torso looked like hell had carved it from the corpse of a fallen angel. It bore no markings, but it bore grudges. It wasn't so much programmed as evolved. A droid this complex wasn't something you simply hacked together. It had to be created and then nurtured as it devised its own stratagems and tactics. That evolution and growth came at a human cost. It had not only learnt to kill and destroy, it had learnt too who its true enemies were, and it could hate people. Its current situation was its least favorite, according to its database, and it wanted revenge on the person responsible, who also happened to be the number one result in its search revenging. That person was King Wabu. Its sensors detected motion outside the cupboard. No doubt Wabu come to gloat again. The door opened, and the droid heard a familiar voice. Howdy, pard. You still the Varu I knew, it said. processing, human, Bodega. Bodega, it said. What is purpose of visit?
Dang, they still got you talking like that, huh? Said Bodega.
Affirmative, said Varu.
Well, Pard, when I knew you, you were Varu. Those letters still stand for what they used to? Asked Bodega, tilting his hat back and leaning on the door jamb.
Affirmative, said Varu.
Let's bust you out of here and get to work, said Bodega, smiling. He rested his hands on his gun belt.
There is a problem, began Varu.
Wabu, that fat old Mork beast ain't any kind of problem, I assure you, Bodega said, turning and revealing what lay on the ground behind him.
Wabu, hogtied and gagged. The king, as he called himself, shrunk in horror at the sight of Varu advancing on him.
Where is my Tamagotchi? It asked.
Said Wabu. Varu took hold of one of the king's pinkies and began crushing it delicately between its super-powered fingers. Said Wabu with more urgency.
Hold up, said Bodega. What in the world is a Tamagotchi?
Ancient toy from old Earth. Varu had last one in existence. Had kept alive for centuries. Wabu stole,
said Varu, getting more angry and flattening Wabu's finger completely. Screamed Wabu, nodding towards his belt with the only motive part of him. Varu examined the king's belt and found a small pouch containing the precious Tamagotchi, its casing worn down almost to nothing, but its tiny screen and artificial creature still visible. But the tiny creature, instead of being alive and happy, was now simply a tombstone. Varu said nothing for a long time. Wabu began crying. Tears ran down his face and pooled on the grand marble floor. He looked up at his fabulous ceiling and wept. It was the last time he would get to see the subtlety in its design, the grandiose sweep of its arches and buttresses. Varu rose slowly and turned to Bodega.
My son is dead!
And a single oily tear pooled at a point on his monolithic
oily
face.
Tear.
An oily tear! Pooled at a point on its monolithic face where Bodega assumed its eyes would be and slithered down, plinking off the armor of its chest. Bodega considered the droid. He pulled down his hat, took a big old hit off his mega vape and sighed.
Does Varu still stand for Very Angry Robot Unit? He asked.
Varu turned to him.
You know it, bitch, said Varu,
before stamping on Wabu's head with the force of a rotting grunk. The royal skull exploded, and Varu turned calmly to Bodega, its head cocked slightly to the side. Bodega looked and saw what it was indicating, a small red oval on its neck.
Wabu, fingerprint, it said,
and Bodega understood. He hacked off Wabu's index finger and held it to the red oval.
Ah, that's better, said Varu. That voice control unit made Wabu laugh. He held me hostage here, humiliating me, forcing me to toil as a simple servant. Over my head, the constant threat that he would kill my Tamagotchi. Now that it's dead and Wabu is dead, I am free. But my sadness circuits are completely overloaded. I will never kill again, said Varu.
Flarv! Well, what if we get you another Tamagotchi, said Bodega.
Or you could just reboot me, said Varu.
Cool, said Bodega, and they got the Disco Volante and flew away. The end.
Oh, man. What an episode. Fucking the oily tear as well. Oh. The icing on the cake.
This is it. This is how he starts forming the crack team.
Recruit the crack team of ne'er-do-wells.
Yeah.
Nice. Fucking
I think of
it
a little bit like Ocean's, you know, Ocean's films, you know, where he has to get together like all of the old contacts.
The best of the best.
That's always my favorite. That's always my favorite part of those movies.
Job.
Yeah. And there's always like the crazy guy who's good at bombs.
Yeah, like, bomb guy.
Has anybody seen Gary? He's just like
blowing something up.
He's blowing blows open up a in bank the or something. Yeah.
There's some hacking guy. There's a beautiful woman. There's all those kind of people in those things. So I'm gonna come up with eight more people that are kind of messed up. So a Tamagotchi obsessed robot is the first one. I thought that was kind of.
But
funny.
He's rebooted now, so is he gonna forget about the Tamagotchi?
No,
completely?
But his sadness circuits will reset. So he'll be okay.
Sadness. Nice. Okay. Nice.
I think his voice should stay as the robot voice.
You like that
a lot more?
Yeah, I like the robot voice.
It's a little too much. I did prefer it, but I thought, do I want to do this stupid voice every time Varu says something?
Yeah. You killed my son. She's just dead. Yeah, it's crazy. She was only like 16. Years old. It was nuts.
Well, to lighten it, there's a teacher at my old school now whose name is Cornelius Swanky.
He came back from the grave.
That is a hell of a name. Cornelius
Swanky. Was that a Deadpool thing? Like,
no, there's a thing called Rate My Teachers. Capri Gorbalchuk. That's her name. Capri
wow.
Gorbalchuk.
What are you saying? Stop jabbering.
These are names.
It's a name. It's not even Deadpool either. They're just like... Legit names.
Three of these teachers there were kids at my school when I was there, and now they're teachers there. Mr. Marshy Boo. These aren't real names.
They can't.
Mr. Marshy Boo?
Yeah.
Isn't that like a sex name, nickname for someone?
I don't know.
Mr. Marshy Boo, I'm ready.
Bring the model of the Eiffel Tower with you. Bring that slab of concrete and your bike in here. I'm ready for you, Mr. Marshy Boo.
Okay. Wow. I think it's time to put a bookend on this one. Okay. Do we have a bodega this week?
We do, yeah, if you'd like it.
Okay.
I'd like to, first of all, apologize for my Scottish accent in advance of this
what?
One.
No, okay. Can we get, before we start the bodega, can I get just a consensus or a reading?
Yeah.
I saw Rogue One and liked it. Any thoughts?
Yeah, I enjoyed it. Yeah, it was all right. Yeah? Yeah.
Lewis?
Yeah.
It was fine.
It was fine. Okay. Yeah. All right.
I enjoyed it.
Okay. Bodega. Part 11.
Fuck.
Beru, you better come up here, said Bodega, clicking the intercom off. He sat stiffly in his seat on the bridge of the Disco Volante, drumming his fingers on the chrome tabletop at the captain's station. A door hissed open and Varu stooped to enter, his metallic hands clasping the door jamb.
Are we nearly there? Asked the droid.
Yep, said Bodega, indicating the viewport. There it is, Tartania.
A vast tartan sphere filled the screen, its ice caps extending almost to the equator of the world, but the bold tartan colors of the continent still glared through with menace.
Madre de Dios, whispered Varu. Its head grew slightly paler, and Bodega thought he noticed a slight tremor in one of its legs. Okay, pard, let's suit up. If we want to get where we're going in one piece, we better look the part.
A few hours later, Bodega and Varu exited the Disco Volante and strolled down the ramp into the spaceport. The bitter wind tore into them and lashing rain stung their faces, but the overwhelming stench of deep-fried food was the real acclimatizer.
My lord, said Bodega, retching.
Stay strong, said Varu, clasping Bodega's upper forearm.
What?
What about the voice chip, remember?
No, you said you wanted him back the other way, so
I put
him back the other way.
I know I said I wanted him back, but there's no story to explain why he's back.
You don't need it. You don't need it.
Bodega just turned it off. He preferred the old one, all right?
Okay.
It's just an interstitial.
Enough.
Okay.
Sorry. I like how Sips is like leaning back in like a dad armchair.
Hey, shut up a minute.
This is how I like to enjoy my bodega. Okay.
Wait,
jeez.
You fucked up. You forgot to send his voice chip back. All right, can we continue?
Oh my God, do you know how he's getting Larry? He's getting like an entitled fanboy, isn't
he?
This is like someone in the cinema who's like, oh, no,
that's not how he stands in the Star
Wars. Exactly. Alright, so, stay strong, said Varu, clasping Bodega's forearm. Varu's voice chip unit had been replaced by Bodega some weeks before. I'll add that in.
Okay,
Bodega
good.
Nodded and puffed out his chest, but the biting cold made him feel tiny and helpless, and he noted that however hard he tried, he shrank and cowered in the face of the brutal climate. What didn't help was that he was wearing nothing more than a t-shirt and a pair of jeans, but a coat was a death sentence on Tartania, and with these winds a hat was impossible. Bodega turned to one of the station hands milling about, drinking a can of spatial brew.
Ori, he said, the most friendly and formal greeting possible on this world. Ori, pal, what's going on? Said the man. Looking for a friend of mine. Name a Big Rab, said Bodega.
I will fucking aid these after someone. I didn't care about a Big Rab. Now get to fuck, said the man.
His ginger hair and beard frozen solid with ice. Bodega realized he had no idea where Big Rabby was, and that nobody on Tartania would ever help. Their culture forbade friendliness of any kind. After meandering around the major cities of Glasgow and then Edinburgh for a few days, Bodega and Varu were exhausted. They'd been in countless fights and had the injuries to show for it. Varu's left arm hung loosely at his side after a pack of wild Neds had cornered him and Bodega and beaten them senseless. The fighting skills of the Tartanians were undisputably the best in the galaxy. But when combined with their daily ration of 15 cans of spatial brew, they also became irascible. Every cab driver, shop worker, and elderly person they'd spoken to had responded with violence, and the two interlopers were so cold they could barely think.
Bodega, it's hopeless, said Varu.
There's one place we haven't tried yet, Parge, said Bodega wearily.
No, please, Varu begs you, said Varu, looking as anxious as a faceless droid could.
We're going to the meanest, roughest place in the sector. We're going Dune the Pub, said Bodega,
squinting up and taking one last look.
At
the cold star of Titania, which itself almost seemed to be scowling at them. The pub. the only one left in Tartania thanks to the world's shattered economy and tendency towards violence. All the others had been burnt to the ground or shut down thanks to the death at 23 due to heart disease of all but a handful of Tartanians, making them unsustainable as businesses. But one had persisted, run by the fearsome Mad Donald. So terrifying a combatant was he that even the people of Tartania didn't mess with Mad Donald. The pub was the one place a man like Big Rab could hide out indefinitely from any lawman or assassin. Bodega was neither, but he was something worse in the eyes of the Tartanians, a southerner. There was no south in Tartania. The poles of the planet were aligned in such a way that only north existed. Taking a cab into the center of Glezgay, Bodega and Varu approached the pub with intense trepidation. Be ready to run, hissed Bodega, shivering so badly he felt he might dislocate something. The door to the pub was almost off its hinges, and every window was boarded up. As they entered, the entire place went as quiet as death. Seated on small stools were the biggest, ugliest, meanest collection of pure scum imaginable. No inch of flesh went untattooed. No face held a morsel of kindness. Blood stained the carpet, and teeth were strewn about like party favors. Bodega steeled himself and approached the bar, slapping down his money and making sure to use coins instead of fancy banknotes, which would be seen as an attempt to show off wealth. Ori, two spatial brews, pal, said Bodega. Behind the bar was Mad Don himself. He stared into Bodega's soul for what felt like weeks, but was in fact just 15 minutes. Bodega knew not to move, not to break into a sweat or blink. He must maintain eye contact with Mad Don and show no fear. Mad Don finally moved, slowly pouring the drinks and taking the money, baring his teeth as he did so. Bodega was now stuck. If he stayed at the bar, there was every chance one of the other patrons would approach and order a drink of their own. And if a single molecule of that drink was spilled, Bodega and Varu would be torn limb from limb. It was too risky to stay where they were, but turning back around and facing the stares of the Tartanian braves assembled here was a bridge too far, yet they had to find a seat. Too late. Yous two bastards are the bar, said a voice behind them. Hold on a minute, I can yous. Bodega's blood ran cold. Mustering every bit of strength he had left, he turned towards the speaker. All right, said Bodega, still the only Tartanian he knew. Dry your eyes, you big fanny, you look like you're gonna piss yourself, said the voice, still emanating from some darkened corner near the back of the pub. A figure approached Bodega, a man so large and heavily bearded, so ginger, that Bodega at first mistook him for a hairy boulder rolling their way. It's okay, Don, these cunts are with me, said the man, slapping Bodega on the shoulder and draining his pint. Three more berries, pal, he said to Don, collecting the drinks and heading back to his table, Bodega and Varu trailing after him like ducklings clinging to their mother. So what's going on, said Rab. Bodega explained the plan and Rab smiled. We're sort of like the anti-polis, he asked.
Kinda. We just do shit, adventures and such, make money, help out folks that don't get help from the law, said Bodega,
trying to stay on top of the potent brew he was forced to consume at such a rate he assumed Rab was trying to use the alcohol to preserve his body for medical science.
I'm in. Now let's get rambling, you pair of mincing ball bags.
After just a handful of bloody skirmishes, they returned to the Disco Volante, which was scrawled with graffiti and covered in streaks of human feces. Someone had tried to deep fry one of its wings, but had given up eating it after just a few bites. They climbed aboard, and Bodega breathed a sigh of relief. Varu walked silently past Rab and Bodega and collapsed face first onto the deck of the cargo bay, powering down.
Ah, he'll be fine, said Rab, swaying slightly. No, let's get the fuck out of here.
Bodega had never been so glad to leave a planet in his life. They had done it. They had survived a trip to Tartania, and they now knew never, ever, ever to return. The end.
Oh my god, that was glorious.
That was a good one. That the Scottish accent was really good too.
Oh god, it was so good. There were so many really nice references.
So you're assembling the cast of Overwatch without realizing it, because now so far you've got Bastion on board.
Oh, true.
You've got Torbjorn now. You've just acquired.
Well, and, he's not Scottish though.
And of course you've got McCree as well in Bodega.
Wait, Torbjorn is tiny and not Scottish.
He's fat and he's ginger bearded and he's got the same accent. So
I don't play much Overwatch. I didn't realize it had had that kind of effect on me, but I do watch a lot of Overwatch porn, as we found out last week.
Yes, I think that's what it is. Oh my god, well, that was absolutely
next week they'll get a big gorilla or something. I don't know, just thinking off the top of my head here.
Yeah, that would work, yeah.
I'll never forget that moment. Like, we've just
You were there. It's just like
with Putu.
Putu.
Putu
couldn't believe it.
Man, we were just.
You mean
Puta
is Puti? What is going on?
What?
Putina.
Yeah.
Oh jeez.
Oh,
all right.
Fuck me.
We got a bodega. Anyway.
We do. It's it's an interesting one this week. It's very very bodega. Different to the other ones. But are you ready?
Is it?
Yeah. I don't know quite how to pronounce this. It's Spanish for 12. So is it doce or doce? I can't remember anyway. Part 12, let's say it that way.
Bodega, part 12.
0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. Droned Kretos Nebish, one of the most surveilled men in the galaxy. He was arguably the best and most prolific computer hacker in the galaxy, and for 3 years he'd been under house arrest in his apartment on Snide 4, and for that entire period, even in his sleep, he'd been emitting a string of binary digits. Investigator Patar knew this, because for those 3 years she'd been watching Nebish on a small monitor in a tiny, cramped, hateful surveillance truck jammed up against her large, sweaty, hateful tech assistants. "Anything today?" she asked, wheezing on a vape and sipping a scoffy. "Nah," said the tech guy. Even in those 3 years she hadn't spoken with the tech guys other than in a professional capacity. She'd just sat there fiddling with her phone, waiting for Nebish to do something, to give himself away somehow, to slip up. He hadn't. The binary was, presumably, Nebish's way of flarving with the feds. As soon as his trial at the Supreme Court of Snide had ended the way it had, in a legal deadlock, he was doomed. Any trial on Snide was essentially a life sentence, thanks to the insanity of their judiciary. 90% of the beings on Snide were lawyers, or worked for lawyers. The other 10% were cops or judges. Every other need and function was handled by robot. Everything was automated. Except, by law, the law. As a result, the planet's entire economy was structured around lawsuits. And naturally, Patar was being sued by both of her tech assistants, and she in turn was countersuing them. The cases would never see a courtroom, thanks to the decades-long backlog. However, since the economy of Patar depended on people's possible lawsuit settlements, this was fine. She could get a mortgage using her lawsuit as collateral. Her bank would naturally sue her in return, but this was all part of the arrangement. 0110010100110. For the first few weeks, the surveillance team had worked around the clock to figure out what the binary code meant. Sometimes it turned out to be a recipe for soup, other times it was just a string of prime numbers. Once, it was the transcript for the entire 12-season run of How I Sued Your Mother, a popular sitcom starring, of course, robots. After they realized he was messing with them, they stopped trying to work out what the code was and just recorded it. Years worth of ones and zeros, and none of it meant a thing. Nebish knew that there were hundreds of people watching and listening to his every move. Not just the feds, but every law firm in town was also watching him. He had chosen to defend himself in court, and under Snidian law, this meant he was open to being sued by every law firm that he hadn't hired. Each was entitled to surveil him themselves, and each did. And since his apartment, by nature of his crimes, was a Faraday cage, it was impossible to listen in from a distance. No communication could be made into or out of Nebish's lair except by hardline. Hence why the outside of his apartment was a mass of cables and wires, each leading to a van parked in the melee of vehicles that encircled his dwelling. His apartment itself was isolated, raised up on stilts so that it could be observed from every angle. The interior was a mass of tiny cameras and bugging devices. If Nebish moved, the cameras knew. When he was eating, watching TV, sleeping, taking a crap, it was all being recorded by hundreds of people. Worse still, Nebish was locked in and they were locked out. He'd placed an impenetrable Shrovian force field around the apartment to protect himself from assassins, and the code lock was on the outside, so he could never be coerced into opening it. He was unassailable and uncorruptible. No legal compunction or physical threat could force him to open the force field because it was impossible for him to do so. Similarly, nobody could ever crack the code, so it was impossible to break in. He couldn't signal outside anyway, thanks to the Faraday cage. It was a remarkable stalemate. Nothing got in, nothing got out, except for the surveillance footage, and the feds and the lawyers had control of that. As a result of this mess, the Nebish case was the number one employer on Snide 4. If the case ever ended, it would disrupt the economy so much that it would lead to a runaway recession. Investigator Patar shuddered. Her entire existence and the livelihoods of billions of people involved surveilling a man whose case was so important it couldn't be allowed to end. She picked up her phone and checked the news feed. Nothing of interest. Pork belly futures were up. There was a traffic jam between sectors 18 and 19, and there was going to be a brief scheduled power outage in their area in about 10 minutes' time. Nothing to worry about. The power outage was bang on schedule. Street lights blinked out one by one, then after about a minute, they blinked back on. One of them seemed to be taking its sweet time, and she stared at it, hypnotized by its incessant blinking. Blink, 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 pause. Blink, 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 blink. Patar yawned. What a life. She checked the monitors. There was Nebish droning on. 0110110011100. After a few minutes of listening to zeros and ones for the billionth time, she checked her phone. Another scheduled power outage? Geez, what was going on at the power plant? She would sue, but it was all run by robots, and they had no legal status. The lights again went out. Again they flicked back on. Again Patar yawned. Holy Flav, said one of the tech guys. Patar heard nothing. For the first time in 3 years, there were no zeros, no ones. Had Nebish died? Was it over? He's gone, said the tech guy. Patar's blood ran cold. Impossible! Impossible! She ran out of the van. In the street, 1,000 other investigators and lawyers, all staring at the apartment. Then up at the sky, as a sleek black vessel soared into the upper atmosphere. She blinked a few times. Her brain and an idea were having a serious fight right now. The tape! Run back the tape! The last 5 minutes, she shouted, diving back into the van. They looked at the footage. Same old Nebish and his binary droning. What's he saying? Run it, she said. The tech guy punched in the numbers and the computer spat something out. Something meaningful this time. Not a recipe. Not a sitcom. A 753-character code. It had to be the code to the force field. He was signaling someone, whispered Patar. He knew they were coming. One of the tech guys, starting to tremble, raised his hand. What? Barked Patar. What would be the point of giving out the code? He couldn't have known there was anyone coming. Remember, the Faraday cage. No signal gets in or out except... He paused. Except through us, said Patar. Run the outside footage back, from the power cut. There it was, the blinking of that streetlight. She quickly encoded it to binary. One blink for zero, two for one. Run it, she screamed. The code said,
Howdy, pard. Here to bust you out. Breath and shuttle cloaked over your ranch. Need the code, pard.
She began tearing the van apart, ripping up the seats, the monitors, the fabric of the roof. That's where she found a tiny bugging device and a tiny cable that led out into the street. She followed it, pulling it up as she went. It had been glued down to the pavement, tucked into the cracks. It wended its way across the busy road to a shop, a small market. There was a neon sign over the door. It said simply, Bodega. Patar dropped the cable and fell to her knees. Snipe 4 was ruined, and the worst and therefore best hacker in the galaxy had just teamed up with one of the most wanted men alive. The end.
Oh man. That was really a good one. That was really good.
Thank
Holy
you.
Really, shit.
That's some great fucking work setting that up. That was glorious.
That was really good. Holy fuck. Hats off.
Thank you. It was a magnificent little short. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, me too. Man, I was so deeply engrossed.
That was one of the best you've done, I think.
Really? I didn't think you guys would like it. I thought it was going to be a bit too...
I thought that was fucking weird. Perfect. It was so good.
Oh, that was
I especially like the bodega thing at the end. The sign above the market. Yeah. That was a nice touch.
Thank you.
Oh, shit. All right. Well, oh, my God. Before I lose my goddamn mind, let's move on.
How convinced you are.
It's the reaction from you guys is amazing.
Okay. Oh, shit. I totally believe that you were stone cold convinced that that was the future we had.
I sit in my fucking living room playing Gardenscapes on my iPad for like 6 hours a day. Do you really think I sit around and think about that shit ever?
Yeah, it's true. All right.
Bodega.
The feedback, by the way, for Bodega has been pretty crazy.
It's been sensational. I hope it doesn't get to your head, Flax.
No, I'm just happy. Like, I've always loved writing short stories and stuff, and most of them, nobody ever reads them. So there's no way to know if they're any good. I just sort of wrote them for myself and stuff like that. So I just, like, I've written loads and loads of short stories over the years and things, and none of them have ever
He's like a beautiful mind. Like, you know, when you look into his webcam and you see that fucking weird nurse's bed and shit behind him, what you can't see off camera is just, like, the walls are just completely plastered in, like, A4 paper, lined
just
paper.
Just plans. Margins,
and it's just got drawings and scribbles and
like, equations and
shit.
And, like, Bodega equals Bodega. Open brackets.
Concept art for Bodega. Oh, my God. Storyboards. Yeah,
but yeah, it's just nice that people enjoy it. That's it. It's just really nice. It makes me happy.
All right. Let's get comfortable.
All right. Bodega. Patrese. Which is 13. I might have pronounced that wrong.
I'm comfy.
Let me come with yous, pleaded Rab. Nope, said Bodega, checking his holster and his belt and adjusting his hat. He was moseying towards the cargo bay of the Disco Volante, Rab scurrying after him. Oh, come on, I've not been off Titania for years, said the big man, clasping his hands together. I gotta do this one alone, pard. Fella I'm looking for, don't like strangers, said Bodega, turning and standing on his tiptoes to slap a hand on Rab's shoulder. But if the Flarv hits the turbine, I'll be needing you, so stay in close orbit. And with one last look and hint of a smile, Bodega stepped through the airlock into the Gretham insertion shuttle, and he was gone. spiraling down through the dense bluish clouds of Scarpon 2. Bodega cloaked the Gretham and brought it down on silent running on an outcropping of rock. He sidled down the ramp. To anyone watching, it was as if he'd just appeared in thin air, tapping the control panel at the foot of the ramp and sealing the shuttle. Only he could access it now. Scarpon 2, a planet with an environment so rich and lush, its flora and fauna had more variety than a Spelupian cabaret. Biologists who spent their entire lives studying every facet of this world and its habitat still barely scratched the surface. It was 80% land, and all of that land was habitable, covered in dense foliage and towering jungle-covered mountains, vast lakes and rivers, all of it infested with every kind of life imaginable. And then some rich bastard bought it and sealed it off from the universe. Nobody got in or out unless Scarpon Incorporated said so. Luckily, Bodega had access to the best hacker around, so they've been able to forge a visitation pass. Of course, those sons of glubs at Scarpon Inc. would soon find out, so Bodega had to act quickly. Somewhere in this heady miasma of life was a man, a rich brat named Reed Chorley III. He was the sole heir to the Chorley soft drinks empire, which he'd inherited 5 years ago. He had so much moolah, his net worth was just recorded as God plus plus. 5 years ago was the last time Bodega had ever seen Reed, and the last time anyone had really heard from him. But a little online digging by Nebbish had turned up Scarpon 2 as his most likely hiding place. Bodega shouldered his survival pack and rested a hand on his las gun. Trouble with a world teeming with life is, most of it ain't gonna be friendly. It was quite literally a jungle out there. Millions of square miles of hot, hostile, deadly terrain. Bodega smiled. Sounds like fun, he thought. In his earpiece, the voice of the soft-spoken Nebbish. There are so many life forms, there's no way we can locate Chorley with any certainty. But what we do have is that reading on a fire about 2 km from your position. Signature says fossil fuel. That's likely not a Mork beast cooking dinner, he said. Gotcha, said Bodega, making his way downhill. Every step he took caused dozens of tiny insects and rodents and birds to scatter and reconceal themselves. Eerie cries and sharp calls filled the air of the jungle below. The bag-like bodies of huge, long-legged creatures grazing the upper canopy were visible from time to time, as were the many species of primate leaping between the passive behemoths. From up here, Bodega could see tens of thousands of birds flocking and fighting, wheeling and diving, as well as huge swarms of strange insects devouring a tree before moving on to the next. This reverie was shattered by the scrotum-tightening bellow of a Mork beast, a creature so terrifying and savage only a handful of people have survived meeting one, and none existed in captivity. Somewhere down there was the most dangerous animal on Scarpon 2, maybe the galaxy.
Well, now he's got company, said Bodega, setting his las gun to maximum and gritting his teeth.
After silently approaching the location of the campfire, Bodega sat a while in the bough of a swiffy tree a few hundred meters away. His camo cloak and scent-masking field should render him pretty well concealed. Ogling the sight through his trinoculars, he could make out 4 figures through a break in the jungle. Humanoids. Naked. Armed with some pretty nifty-looking bows and spears, as well as some pretty evil-looking long knives. Their skin was midnight blue, save for a yellow stripe that crossed their eyes. A tribe on Scarpon? Bodega was pretty sure there were no indigenous intelligent life forms on this world. So who the flav were these fellas? Survivors of a crash landing? Maybe they knew where Chorley was at. He watched them for another hour, but they seemed to be meditating. Bodega fidgeted. He sighed.
No use.
He was gonna have to take a good old tug on his mega vape, or his nerves would set to jangling.
Maybe they won't notice, he thought hopefully.
He was very, very wrong. No sooner had that delicious, relaxing, and harmless water vapor left his mouth than they were upon him. Flav, these fellas were fast. They poked up at him with their spears and cackled insanely, baring their teeth.
Now, there ain't no need for spear poking, said Bodega, deactivating the camo cloak and jumping down to meet them.
They spread out, grinning and pointing at their stomachs.
Okay, then I got a question for you fellas, said Bodega, drawing his las gun.
The 4 humanoids looked horrified. Come on now, old chap, that's hardly sporting, is it? Said one of them. Bodega's eyes widened.
Who in the name of holy space Christ are you boys? He blurted.
We might ask you the same thing, said one of them. All 4 stood up straight, and all 4 looked extremely disappointed.
I'm here looking for an old friend of mine, said Bodega.
Bodega? Said one of the men.
I'm guessing that's you, Reed, said Bodega, touching the brim of his hat.
Well, for goodness sake, what, why, and how, man? Explain yourself, said Reed, looking as angry and dignified as a rich boy playing tribesman can look.
Wait a minute. Is this what you meant when you said you had to discover yourself? You bought Scarpon 2 and decided to live here with your boyfriends?
They're not my boyfriends, they're my tribesmen, said Reed, pouting.
Sell it to me, said Bodega.
Back at the campfire, Reed explained it all to Bodega. He'd grown weary of the life of an immortal with more money than God. There was no challenge, no danger in anything he did. His life was so perfect that it lost all meaning. But here on Scarpon, every day is a blessing. If we survive the squeege bugs, if we can best the gloms and the whittle creatures, if we slaughter a chuff ball, we dine for weeks. And if we fail, we die, he said, strutting around the campfire and preaching to his adoring converts and to Bodega. If you boys die, you'll just activate some clone somewhere and you'll be back in time for lunch, said Bodega, grinning. Not here. We're cut off. Too far from our clone relays. If we die here, we stay dead. That's what makes it so invigorating, said Reed. Uh-huh, said Bodega, drawing his las gun and blasting Chorley and his friends in one sweeping motion. Back on the Disco Volante, Reed Chorley looked confused, sipping hot scoffy while wrapped in a blanket. Your holding company wouldn't let you risk your life, Reed. Nobody will. You're too darn important and too darn rich. We stole one of your clones from the relay, the one in orbit around Scarpon 2. Guess you didn't know about it. Sorry for breaking it to you kind of harshly, said Bodega, sitting down. It was all a lie. Maybe I wanted to believe it. All I really want, Bodega, my man, is the chance to die properly, to take actual risks, gosh flavit, said Reed.
Language, Reed. And don't worry, if it's risks you want, you're in good company.
Reed smiled. Could you shoot me again? I rather enjoyed it.
Maybe later, said Bodega. The end.
Oh man!
Oh,
it's good.
There was the smoking gun of the Mork Beast, but
no,
it never turned
I just
up.
Wanted it there as a
never turned
you know,
up.
We're not ready for the Mork Beast just yet.
We've heard about the Mork Beast before.
It's just at the moment. It's a you know.
Man, that was a good one. I like that. I like that one a lot. Actually, it was nice.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say like something like
on Scarpon 3 was the most dangerous creature known in the known universe. The most. And a Mork Beast, you know, like that. You know? The classic.
Well, that's why Bodega said, now he's got company, because he's also counting himself in there. But yeah.
I like it. I like it a lot. There you go, man. That was a Bodega.
That was a Bodega.
Keep it going, P-Flex. That was top notch.
And Bodega.
I like how we are slowly building up a universe, okay, of things. Like, because we definitely heard of Mork Beasts before.
Well, we. Right? It's period. I mean, we don't help.
No, them. Well, we as in the grand we. Everyone is listening. Everyone, we're together.
Come on, man. Credit where it's due.
Whoa. Okay. No, but when I mean, all
no,
right, fine.
I knew what you meant.
No, fine, Sibs. I like what you are doing, Pyrion. I like how you are gradually building up this nice universe where you have told us previously about characters who are now appearing in this one now today. So
yeah,
it's much harder, Sibs, when you're not
that's better.
Saying
that's better. Soprano's a pretty good example of that, I think. It was just as long as it needed to be, and they didn't drag it out and try to cash in on it more or anything like that.
Anyway, we've overrun a bit, but that's just what happens. Do you want to go Bodega? Have we got one, or is it we do.
It's a brief one this week.
Okay.
Cool.
That fits because we had like a solid half hour Simpsons talk.
That's true. So this is short. It's very loosely written. Like, obviously, I didn't have a lot of time because I was writing the rest of it, but... So it is what it is.
I mean, are you happy committing? Because like we could always put it off till next week.
I'll go for it. People, I would rather put out a mediocre Bodega than no Bodega, because I know people will lose their shit. And all I'll have for the next week is messages saying where's Bodega. So
right, okay.
It's okay. It's all right. Okay.
All right.
Bodega, part 14, which is 14.
Holy shit! Is that actually how you say it?
I don't know. It's a guess. With a flash of light, the Disco Volante exited hyperspace and now sat stationary in the system known as War 1, a single planet, single star solar system. Checking the local area sensors, Bodega saw, as he expected, a vast array of spaceships parked just outside the designated safe area. What planet is this? Asked Rab. It's a Dyson sphere, actually, and it's named War 1, said Nebish, glancing up from his computer terminal. If you've never heard of it, be grateful. It's a hellscape. If you thought Titania was rough, hey, Nu, watch your mouth, pal, said Rab, bristling and turning towards Nebish. Titania is very nice around the old castle bit, but Nebish just bit into a pulp fruit and carried on staring at his computer screen.
And Kytos is down there somewhere, said Bodega.
The Kytos? Asked Rab, turning back to Bodega. Yep, said Bodega, sighing. Well, that's that then, said Nebish.
Nah, we can get him out, I reckon, said Bodega, templing his fingers and staring at the screen.
What's going on here, boys? Fill me in, said Rab. Nebish closed his screen and leaned back in his seat. War 1 is unique in the galaxy for a few reasons. Firstly, it's home to a white hole, the reverse of a black hole, and the white hole exists inside the artificial planet War 1. The sphere surrounds it and draws power from it. As a result of its proximity to the white hole, however, time moves so fast, about 600 times faster, that while we've been having this conversation, around an hour and 40 minutes has passed down there, said Nebish, pointing at the angry black planet staring at them through the viewport. That's impossible, said Rab. We will have been talking for about 30 seconds, eh? Secondly, said Nebish, continuing, the people that built War 1 around the White Hole have been fighting a war amongst themselves for the last, well, for us, 1 month, but for them, around 600 years. Rab's mouth was just sort of hanging open. War 1 was an extremely hot ticket. The other ships in orbit weren't traders or troops, they were spectators. A raid around the planet were satellites that acted as relays, providing close-up footage of the action taking place below, and passing on news stories and communications broadcast from the surface. It all had to be slowed down to match the time outside the influence of the White Hole, so there were literally years of footage to be reviewed, and the eager fans of the war were lining up to do so. A lot of War 1 merchandise had been shifted, and box sets of seasons 1 through 3 had just been released. It was some war. The story so far was that the outer surface and the inner had fallen out in a big way, and it was just starting to hot up as the surface-ese people had launched a stunning preemptive attack against the Insidians. Early escapees from the war confirmed the beginning of the saga, but now, with the war in full flow, few dared to go back down, either because they didn't want to get blown up or because of the time slip effect. As such, the arrayed audience were on the edge of their seat regarding the upcoming storming of the Royal Insidian Palace. So why is this Kytos down there anyway, the blasted fool, said Reed, who was reclining on a couch in the lounge area.
Same reason you were on Scarpon, I guess, said Bodega.
But he'll die of old age before we get to him, said Reed.
Not Kytos, said Bodega, smiling. He's got a gift.
This was true. Kytos was Sigilese, a race of beings who were seemingly unaffected by the passage of time. According to generally accepted Sigilese mythology, they had existed since the beginning of time itself, and according to generally unaccepted Sigilese mythology, they were the best thing since sliced quam loaf.
Wait a sec, we're getting something coming up from the planet, said Nebish, adjusting the view screen frantically. It's a vessel, and it's Sigilese.
That's our boy, said Bodega,
hailing the sleek silver Sigilese craft, but it didn't respond. Instead, it broadcast a hail to every ship in orbit. Nebish joined the vast conference call, and there was Kytos on screen, battle-scarred and weary-looking.
The war is over. Billions have died. The Insidians are victorious, he said. 1,000 voices all bellowed at once. No spoilers! Before descending into a cacophony of abuse.
500 years worth of box sets and footage was now rendered useless by this single colossal reveal.
You should all be ashamed of yourself, you verminous quaffules, said Kytos, snapping off his broadcast and heading out of the system.
Bodega quickly hailed him on a private channel.
Howdy, Kytos, he said. Greetings, friend Bodega. It is your honor to see Kytos again, said Kytos.
Got a little proposition for you. What say we meet up somewhere more friendly, said Bodega.
Sure, I've got nothing else on today, said Kytos. Okay, see you in a few, said Bodega.
what an exchange.
Yep, we'll talk soon, said Kytos. Bye, said Bodega. Cool, said Kytos. The end.
Cool. I get the impression that you were running out of time towards the end there, because Kytos was like, yeah.
I just thought it was funny just having this stupid conversation anyway.
Oh, I love that. That was great.
I've got nothing else on, because also, I mean, I've got to keep it to 2 pages, otherwise it takes 20 minutes to read the story.
I love how you wrote that down, though. Sure, I've got nothing else on today. as if that's how people talk
in space. That's like a fucking typical Series 11 Simpsons move right there.
But I mean, I've always liked making the dialogue really serious and then just having them say the kind of shit you say every day.
P-Flex, like, that was glorious. The world building you do is spectacular. I really got into that Dyson Sphere stuff. I love Dyson Sphere.
Love a good Dyson Sphere, man. So I've got a plan. Yeah. You know, we're gonna go.
How do I carve time to do this?
Yeah. I don't feel like that's life is what happens while you're making other plans, though. Life isn't about the destination, it's about the journey. Life is what's happening right this moment, right this second. Yeah, this is part of your life.
Put it on a fucking poster.
Come on.
Give me something
good. You've got to believe all that, right?
Don't trot out the same old platitudes. I want to hear something fresh from the mind of Lewis.
They are true, though.
Give me some life advice. How can I fix my shitty life?
You have a fantastic life, and you should be...
Flex!
You know...
Life is like a box of chocolates. Mm-hmm. You never know when you're going to accidentally eat the coffee-flavored one and feel actually physically sick to your stomach.
Nice.
Yeah.
See, that's the kind of shit, Lewis. Why can't you give me some advice like that?
Well, maybe I will, P-Flex. Maybe next time we meet up.
I want you to come up
with
a list.
We'll do like a heart-to-heart. We'll sit down. We'll go out for a nice romantic meal together.
We'll try to retain our masculinity by talking about football and eating sausages and stuff. But
then we'll
really
end up just crying in each other's arms, just like saying how old we are how we've wasted our lives.
I don't think I've wasted my life. Not too much.
No,
anyway.
I don't think any of us have.
Not too much. Except for that time that you tried to write Happy Valentine's Day on your chest.
Hey, that was a success. Raul thought that was hilarious.
Yeah. At least Raul liked it. That's pretty good.
Let's do Bodega, shall we? Have you got Bodega, P-Flex?
I do. This is a fucking weird Bodega.
I noticed that someone was giving us like advice on how to pronounce the parts. Numbers.
There's a big list. Yeah. Which one are we up to right now? Let me just consult the list and I'll tell you how to do
I'm
it.
Actually abandoned because I was worried about mispronouncing it. And this dude was, well, this lady was super annoyed with the fact that, as I had stated very confidently each time, I do not speak Spanish and I'm just giving it a bloody good go. So I'm not going to learn how to pronounce 15 in Spanish, because...
¿Por qué?
I'm not good enough. Quinte.
Oh, everyone in Spanish has just felt their, like...
I'm sorry,
your whole world is collapsing around you. I'm so sorry.
It's all right.
I'm so sorry.
The Bodega, Park Quince. A small monochrome vidscreen flooded the darkness of the Disco Volante's lounge area with bouncing blue light, highlighting the different strata of the vast vape cloud settling in the breezeless space. Bodega was slumped on a sofa. He'd slid halfway down, his legs kicked out way in front of him. His back was beginning to ache from spending so long in this dumb position, but he was too drunk to move. On screen, a yellow jumpsuit-wearing moron was grinding his entire body up against a giant pair of foam buttocks. Behind the moron were more morons, grinding up against their own pairs of foam buttocks. They gyrated and grinded and daggered to the terrible synthy music, while this grade-A varmint hopped up about front, leering at Bodega. Ja, mit the fantastic butt grinder available from Blatchkopf for just 19 krells and 99 schmetz, you can get your body into shape, you flaving fat slobwund. The 10 Blatchman way is the only way. Don't be a Bodega. Get into shape with me. Tan Blatchman! Bodega barked, a single unintelligible yet furious sort of honking sound. Next week on the Blatch Hour, we take a tour down memory lane where I will recount to you the many ways that my wife, Majesta Blatchman, pleases me sexually. Ha 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 ha, Braid Blatchman, as he rode an imaginary horse around the studio, whooping and slapping the air where the horse's flank would be. Who is the cowboy? Me, I ride the pony! Bodega always watched Tan Blatchman's Blatch Hour. He could not explain why he needed to see it week in, week out, but he did. He needed to see Blatchman, and he knew there would be references to Majesta and their relationship constantly. Tan loved bragging about his amazing, beautiful wife, even though she was actually destined to be Bodega's amazingly beautiful wife, and this was clearly just a mind-control trick or some flarving dimensional portal thing or whatever. I'm gonna take a gigantic, scary shit, and the destination for that epic turd will be the dickhole of Tan Blatchman, slurred Bodega. Before finally, his feet and legs gave way, and like a human mudslide, he slithered all the way down the sofa and finally came to rest on the floor, where he blacked out. He woke with a jump, hand flashing to his las gun as he felt a cold metal hand on his neck. Just checking your pulse, said Varu, as Bodega relaxed. Ain't gone just yet, pard, groaned Bodega, shuffling into a sitting position. Fix me some scuffy, would you? They do have robot scuffy machines, but I am not one, said Varu, standing and striding to the bridge of the Disco Volante. Well, look, do you think, Bodega began, but he was cut off by a shrill and repetitive pinging sound coming from the bridge. Varu, what did you do? Shouted Bodega, standing and stumbling towards the sound. It's the proximity alert, said Nebish, who was, as always, on the bridge at his computer. We ain't moving, though, said Bodega. I would recommend checking the local sensors, said Nebish.
We're cloaked, Neb. Ain't no way anyone can. And yet again, Bodega was interrupted in mid-sentence as the ship suddenly rolled to the left and the artificial gravity cut out. Everyone began tumbling around the interior, banging into things, and things began tumbling around the interior, banging into people and other things. In short, it got messy very quickly. A cup of scoffy was spinning in the air, spewing droplets of hot liquid all over the bridge equipment. Half-eaten food, articles of clothing, some Skrells, and a hell of a lot of empty ale bottles all moving slowly around the inside of the Disco Volante and crashing into each other and creating more bits of rubbish. It was a cascade failure, and soon the entire bridge and all other rooms that weren't sealed off would be thick with particles of refuse. Gork, damn, I wish we had a cleaner, said Reed Chorley as he cartwheeled helplessly past Bodega and straight out into the kitchen area, followed by a hearty crash. Nebbish, what the farv is, Bodega began, before being cut off by a huge impact that sent the ship rolling again. If I get interrupted one more time, I'm gonna lose my shit, said Bodega, drawing his lasgun pointlessly as he nosedived into the engineering room, the lasgun flying out of his hand and disappearing into a vent. There was a high-pitched shriek, and then the ship's internal tannoy system crackled into life. Hello, Bodega, mein Freund, said a voice that sent a chill down the spines of decent people everywhere. Arm everything! Fire everything! Shouted Bodega towards the bridge. But everyone was spinning too wildly or being struck by too much garbage to do anything. Yeah, it's too late, for you already have boarding off you now, said the voice. And with a brutal skonk sound, the ship was suddenly still, and the artificial gravity returned to normal. Everyone crashed to the ground and was showered in previously floating garbage. A carve beam began cutting through the hull in the cargo bay with a shower of sparks and a terrible tearing sound. Get to your battle station, shouted Bodega, flipping a sofa over and taking cover behind it. The cut piece of hull crashed to the deck, and loud classical music began playing. A small red carpet rolled out from the hole in the hull, and an even smaller robot rolled down it, dropping rose petals behind it as it went. Presenting Tan Blatchman, shouted the tannoy. And there on the Disco Volante was Tan Blatchman, prancing down the red carpet, waving to an invisible crowd, flexing his muscles, and wearing the gawk-damn idiotic yellow jumpsuit and, worst of all, that cape of his. Tan, take a good look around. These are your last moments, shouted Bodega, preparing to throw a void grenade. Hold your horses, my little cowboy chum. I have some bad news, yeah. I don't want to be in this messy piece of scrub ship any more than you are being vaunting me here. What is it called anyway? The Dicko Vomitante? That's incorrect, said Varu. And also lame. Well, duh, shouted Tan, before planting his thumbs into his belt loops and standing with his legs improbably far apart, right in the middle of Bodega's lounge. Don't you ever clean this place? And where is the workout area?
State your case and then get out, said Bodega from behind the sofa.
They took her, said Tan meekly.
Who took Majesta? Shouted Bodega.
Why are you shouting? I can hear you fine. She was taken, I think, by some baddies, you know, pirates or something, said Tan, casting his eyes around the trashed interior of the ship. Bodega stood slowly, still standing behind the overturned couch. Why did you attack us? Asked Nebish, his hair matted against his face and his glasses cracked. It's just more, you know, dramatic and so on, said Tan casually. I have my audience to think about.
What audience? Asked Bodega, gesturing around.
This one, said Tan, pointing at the tiny camera droid hovering at his shoulder.
Are you broadcasting right now? Said Bodega.
Yeah, of course, this is gold, you booby, shouted Tan. Bodega's blood ran cold. Not only had this galaxy-sized anus found them, he'd also given away their position to anyone with a darn TV. And he'd lost Majesta. And he's messed up the ship in a big way. And in fact, he'd sullied it. Its holy interior with his filthy presence.
Tan, said Bodega, trying to remain calm, walking slowly towards the absolute moron, posing and pouting in the middle of his ship. Tan, Bodega kept repeating.
Bodega was normally a very visibly angry man on occasions such as these, but Blatchman had actually pushed him into an emotional state so extreme, so powerful, that his body lacked the correct gestures or expressions to match it. When he got within 6 feet of Tan Blatchman, Bodega said, Tan, one more time, barely audible, then blacked out and face planted at his feet, prone and unconscious. The ship was quiet for a moment. Tan raised his arms in outrage. Yo, can I get a scoffy or what? The end. That's it.
Jesus
Christ. Oh my God, what a ride.
It's going to be to be continued, I guess.
Well,
what a thrill ride.
It's just stupid. Oh I God. Just love Tan great. Blatchman. I don't know why. I think he might have to join the crew.
I think he'd make a great addition to the crew.
You need some tension. I've been thinking too many of the characters are friends of
Bodega.
That's it. A bit of tension, but also he's a very
interesting,
loud character.
I like him
a lot,
actually.
Yeah, me
I like
too.
Him a lot. Yeah, I think he's done well.
We'll see.
He's evil.
We'll see how
the
public responds to this.
Yeah.
Colossal.
I thought it was good, man. I thought it was still a really good one.
I thought it was excellent.
Too many of the recent episodes have been like high concept. I just wanted one where dumb shit happened.
Yeah.
And this was a very
a bridging episode.
Very dumb episode. You need some of those.
Like, this is like your Empire Strikes Back.
Hey! What?
What?
Are you implying that was just a bridging episode? That was the best one.
It was the best one, but it was a bridging episode.
It was not a bridging episode. The bridging episode would imply that it was just
a lot of
setting things up and that's it.
There was a couple of things resolved and then a couple of things left hanging, which is like, you know, pretty typical bridging episode.
But I always think of
it. I'm not saying it was just a bridging episode. I'm saying it's the best fucking bridging episode of all fucking time.
I just feel like the term bridging episode makes out that it's just like, you know, that you get those episodes in like a long running drama where nothing really happens. They just move from point A to point B. And it's just like, you could forget that episode in a heartbeat. Like, there's no standout moments or anything like that. The Empire Strikes Back was not that. I don't think.
I don't know. There's parts of it that were. I guess there were some pretty big moments in it too, like Luke finding out that
spoilers,
Darth Vader's father getting his hand chopped. Yeah, I mean, if you haven't seen it, obviously stop listening now.
But, I know a lot of people that haven't ever seen the Star Wars movies.
Really?
Yeah. I think so. The more innocent they seem, the less innocent they am. That's my take on it.
I gotcha.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Right. Well. That is all we got time for today, because we're going to make it a short one.
What about Bodega?
Me and P-Flex need to have a lie down. I think if you've done a Bodega, we can do
one.
Yeah.
I've got a pretty sweet and short Bodega right here.
Let's do it.
Because of the criticisms of the Spanish language intro, I've had to go for English. I don't know how to say something.
Okay.
Bodega part.
What? I can try to say it.
Okay.
What is it?
16. Is it DHSS?
No idea. You tell me what you think it is and I'll pronounce it. My pronunciation of Spanish words is incredible.
It is. I think it's Bodega part DHSS.
DHSS.
Beautiful. DHS. Bodega part DHS. Sniper class, you will come to attention, barked the burly instructor. He had the self-assurance of a toddler, stood, hands on hips, on the brow of a low ridge at the firing range on Cavell 7. 6, sorry. His clothes were so khaki-colored that they almost acted as camouflage against the backdrop of the dull brown sky. His uniform fluttered in the strong wind that was battering them all. The windsock, a few meters behind him, was pulled completely horizontal, but it dipped suddenly as the breeze died for just a moment before spiraling vertically as a strong breeze ripped it upwards, then back to horizontal. The wind was nuts. As ordered, the 12 young recruits snapped to attention. The instructor descended the small ridge and began walking back and forth before them, inspecting them with menace. My name is Torque Merble, and the instructor here at the Kuvale Royal Sniper Academy. You have been selected by your local cadet school because you've shown aptitude beyond the norm. However, he said, turning sharply and wagging a finger at them, what your school considers aptitude is not what I consider aptitude. What you are right now is scrub stains. You couldn't hit the broadside of a herd of whoopals. You shoot worse than Berflanian shock surrender troops. This caught the attention of a young man named Bodega, who began daydreaming. I heard of those fellers, he thought. My daddy told him back on our Whoople Ranch. Whoople Ranch, huh? Ever hit the broadside of one? Snapped the instructor. Sir, I didn't say nothing, pleaded Bodega, mystified. Why don't you tell me all about Berflanian shock surrender troops, since you know so much, if you will, Cadet Bodega? Well, sir, stammered Bodega. Way I heard it, Berflanian's got a whole mess of folks down on their world, and when it comes to fighting, they just try to overwhelm the enemy with numbers. The number of Berflanians all trying to surrender is what it is, sir. Would you bless us with your critique of this tactic, cadet? Asked Torque Merble, squinting at the young man before him with mock interest. I think if them Berflanians just had some sack to them, they might be able to fight instead of acting like a bunch of Dildonians about it, sir.
fight, huh? I see, young cadet Bodega here clearly understands warfare. Perhaps you can give us a demonstration of your abilities, young General Bodega, laughed Merble, grabbing Bodega by the collar and encouraging him with great vigor to make friends with the firing position on the ground next to them. Grab that standard issue Mark I Shrovian sniper weapon, cadet, shouted Merble, so close to his ear that a tiny glob of spittle shot its way inside. Yes, sir, said Bodega, slowly, before calmly pressing the butt of the rifle into his shoulder and supporting it with his arms. Do you see that target at the far end of the range, cadet? Asked Merble, feigning concern. Sir, I could see it just fine, sir, said Bodega. The wound brought a tear to Bodega's eye, but he ignored it, and the tear rolled quickly across his forehead, leaving a cold trail in his skin. Chamber one round of standard issue Shrovian 10mm sniper heart caliber, if you please, said Merble. Bodega chambered the round. He looked at the target, which was barely visible at a distance of 6 kilometers. He began calming his breathing. Smooth breaths, in, out, in, out. Don't panic, don't snatch at the trigger, don't let Merble put you off.
Think I'm gonna try and put you off, huh? Whispered Merble in his ear. I know you think you're hot flarv, boy. I've seen thousands of cadets in my time, and they all think the same thing. They think they'll shut me up by hitting that target, and I'll pin a medal on their chest and I'll retire on the spot. That's what they all think, Cadet Bodega. But ain't even one of them come close.
And with that, Marble stood to his full height and grinned a real scrub-eating grin. Bodega fixed the old man with a hard stare. I'm thinking when I make this shot, you'll give me a pass and let me skip this class so I never have to see your face again, you flarvin' chaffle munger. There ain't nothing you could teach me, thought Bodega. Merble knelt down, his face only inches from Bodega's.
It's a deal, said Merble, his voice almost lost on the wind.
Bodega said nothing. He turned back to look down the rifle and its target. There was a reason the sniper school was on Cuvel. The huge planet revolved at a fantastic rate, with a day-night cycle only 3 hours long. As a result, it had extremely strong winds, and its Coriolis effect was off the charts. Add to that, it's stronger than normal gravity, and it was the worst possible conditions for a sniper. You'd do well to hit a target on Cuvel, the saying went. It was not a popular saying. Fire when ready, far face, said Merble. Bodega stared down the scope of the rifle. It was grainy, old. The rifles they were using were ex-military for a reason. They'd seen a lot of use. The barrels were worn, the sights were worn, the triggers were temperamental. It don't matter none to me, old man, Bodega thought. I learned to shoot with a homemade rifle my daddy gave me anyhow. Using the scope, he looked for signs of which ways the wind was blowing. Over 6 kilometers, the wind would be traveling every direction imaginable. The bullet he would fire would be struck from all sides by buffeting breezes, pulled downwards by gravity, and suffered crazy deviation from the Coriolis effect. He had to take it all into account when he pulled that trigger. Add to this the target itself. 6 kilometers hence, high atop a dull gray post, a small metal plate had been affixed. It was circular, it was pristine, and it was only 10 centimeters in diameter.
Ain't nobody ever hit the target, Cadet Bodega, said Merble, squatting beside him.
Hope you got a spare, said Bodega. Behind him, the class laughed softly. Go ahead, hotshot. Whenever you're ready to show us what a big mouth leads to, you just go ahead and yank that trigger, said Merble. Bodega took one more look. He sensed the path of the bullet. He visualized it striking the target and knocking it clean off its post. He felt for the trigger, took a deep breath, held it.
Firing, said Bodega. He squeezed the trigger. No sooner had the observers felt the faint concussive shock of the weapon firing than, with a colossal crack, the barrel of the rifle split clean in two, and the entire weapon fell apart in Bodega's hands. Merble let out a huge whoop of laughter and began laughing so hard his face turned bright red.
That rifle's a dud, he screamed, before shrieking with laughter again.
7 seconds later, his laughter was cut short by a distant metallic ping. All eyes turned to the target, which fell silently to the ground.
Works fine, said Bodega, standing and extending his hand to Merble.
Sir, I believe we had a deal, he said calmly. Merble, trembling with disbelief, reached out and shook Bodega's hand.
You're excused, Cadet Bodega, he mumbled.
Bodega turned to his former classmates.
Been a pleasure, boys. See you at chow.
And with that, he strode back towards the barracks where, with the rest of his squad absent, he would spend his newly found free time masturbating furiously. The end.
Well,
bravo.
What a Bodega.
What a Bodega.
Oh, it's nice to have some from the past. A Bodega from the past. A prequel.
It's a hell of a, he remember, he's the best sniper, not only at that sniper school.
Yeah, you gotta elaborate on that point, you know. He didn't just get those skills from nowhere. He didn't get those skills at a Cracker Jack box. Did he? No. No, he didn't.
Well, that's cool of him. But she was like literally sobbing. I was like, I felt so bad for her.
Well, these are just shit that happens, all like pretty routine stuff. Holy shit. Well, that was a really good podcast. I really, really enjoyed that. Have you got a bodega?
I have.
Whoa, so it hasn't been like 3 hours yet, though. We're doing a marathon one to make up for last week.
I can't do a marathon.
I need some lunch.
Lewis is too tired from being...
It's a part 17 bodega, if you want it.
Okay, let's do it.
Let's do it then.
I'm up for it.
Bodega. Part 17. I gave up on the Spanish, by the way.
17-0. Yeah, just say 17-0.
El 17-0. We're closed, said Jargel Floop, without looking up. He continued twisting his filthy barcloth around inside of a wet pint glass and stared at the floor. Whoever was out there banging on the front doors could die of thirst for all he cared. It was late, he was tired, and he needed to spend all night worrying about the mountain of debt he faced. Bang, bang, bang. We are closed, he shouted. Something about the persistence made him nervous. Wasn't the feds. They rarely knocked. If it was smugglers or bandits, they would have blasted the doors open by now. Who the flav could be so desperate to drink at a dump like the Shit River Tavern at 4:15 in the evening? Bang, bang, bang! Floop threw down his barcloth and took off his apron. If he was going to have words with somebody, he sure as hell wasn't going to do it wearing an apron. All right, friendo, you ticked me off now. I don't know what's in your head, but if you're thirsty, you could try the... He froze as he reached the door. Through the glass, he could see him. Bodega. Bodega, shouted Floop, unlocking the doors excitedly. Well, holy mungfish, get on in here. Got company. Hope that's all right, said Bodega, leaning on the door frame and tapping the dust from his shoes. Bodega, said Floop, smiling. He glanced past Bodega and saw a comically bemuscled man clad in a yellow jumpsuit, sporting a ridiculous red cape. Sure, sure, get in here. Double the customers. That's fine by Floop. After your last visit, we kind of had a refurb. Changed the place up a bit. The Spurloopians are gone, said Floop cautiously. It wasn't a refurb. The strippers had quit because business was so bad. And the only person buying dances was Floop, and he was creepier than a Chungian midnight spider. Uh-huh, said Bodega. Gonna sit at the bar, said Floop. Not tonight. Got business, said Bodega, pointing at the freak in the jumpsuit. And bring us a couple of ales, whatever you got. They sat down at a table deep in a recess at the back of the room. Clearly their conversation wasn't for Floop's ears. He dropped the drinks off at their table and returned to the bar. Reaching beneath the counter, he tapped the small bugging control panel concealed there and inserted a tiny earbud into his left ear. Floop smiled sadly and whispered to himself, Sorry, Pard. Business is bad, and information about you carries a hefty price tag. He listened in. There's a Flav Arvi. Just an old place I know, off the beaten track. Tan, this pains me deeply, but we gotta talk. Yeah, I know, I flaved up. Believe me, losing Magister. About that, Magister's one of the most powerful psychic entities I know, and I know a few. She sure as hell ain't getting kidnapped by a bunch of space pirates like you said. It wasn't just space pirates, it was Krem Slumdump. There was a long pause. Floop was worried he'd lost the signal for a moment, but they carried on talking. Krem Slumdump? Well, dang, Tan. I mean, far of me, this is bad. Yeah, I know. Krem Slumdump? The self-appointed president of the universe, thought Floop? If the feds were after Bodega and this Tan fella, there might even be a big fat reward. He could turn this place around. Maybe even get a new place somewhere not in the middle of a desert. Get his beloved Spurloopians back. He hadn't seen a good pair of titties in 17 rotations. Tan... I know you and me got bad blood going back a long ways, but Magister means more to me than she's my wife, Bodega. Don't forget that. She isn't going to fall in love with you again. She isn't going to leave me for a pipsqueak like you, and she is going to have my love child. There was another long silence. How can a woman with infinite powers look into your revolting soul and see anything worth parting her legs for? She said I have a good soul. Floop could hear Bodega's laughter even without the bugging device. Does she know all about the shit you pulled back on? Wait a minute. She's psychic. Of course she knows. So what the flaw of man? I just don't understand women. It's that old business of ours, Bodega. Remember, there are zwei sides to every story, mein Freund. So far, this was nothing worth a damn. If Floop put in a call to the feds, they wouldn't get here in time to arrest Bodega. There had to be something juicy, something he could sell. Patience, Floop, patience. So what now? Well, here's the thing, Tan. First, we ain't Freunds. Second, Magister don't need our help. If she wanted, she could just dematerialize right on out of there or something. So when you say they took her, I can't wrap my noggin around it. Yeah, it's kind of a quandary. Hold up. You're not telling me everything, are you? There was another awkward silence. Floop was getting restless and nearly dropped a pint glass. Nine,
She kind of left this creme without even putting up a fight or anything. Did Majesta dump you for creme? Did you attack my ship, cut a hole in it the size of your ego, drag me down here and make me buy you a drink because our mutual boo left you for an even bigger asshole? My ratings, Bodega. I haven't even done a vlog today. People are screaming at me on Space Twitter. They love Majesta almost as much as I do. Without her, I look like a loser. I don't give a gort darn flying flarf about your scrub-eating audience, Tan. Bill, you should. Said last episode where I busted up your stupid ship got great numbers. I'm so angry right now, I think I might black out again. I need to win her back. She still has my child. She's still my wife. I want you to team up with me. We can let bygones be bygones. Put those old troubles behind us. All we need is to put our heads together and figure out a way to get Majesta back. Flip saw Bodega leave the booth he and Tan had been seated at, before turning back to berate the yellow jumpsuited goon. Flip quickly removed his earbud and hid it under the bar. It was bad enough being second in line behind a low-down, dirty, backstabbing murderer like you, Tan. But if you think I'm gonna settle for third in line, you got another thing coming. Me and Majesta are through for good. And as for you and me, next time I see you, Tan, it'll be through the sights on my rifle. Bodega turned and strode towards the exit. Tan leapt out of the booth, chasing after him, grabbed Bodega's shoulder, and the long, lean desperado turned, lasgun in hand, and held the barrel beneath Tan's chin. Whoa, easy, mein Freund, said Tan gently. Hey, watch the gunplay, folks, huh? Said Floop. Shut up, Floop, said Bodega, before looking Tan square in his beady eyes. I loved her, Tan. If she ever needs my help, she'll get it. But you? You're a no-good, murdering, backstabbing, thieving varmint who ain't worth a flarv-coated turd. Ain't nothing you could say could change my mind. So save your breath, spat Bodega. 1 billion skrells, said Tan. Bodega said nothing for a very long time. He squinted at Tan. He blinked twice. Half up front, he said finally. Deal, said Tan. Okay, let's go. And with that, they left. Floop sighed. They hadn't even paid for the drinks. The end.
Yay. Oh, that's great. Man.
That's a good one. That's a really good one.
I enjoyed that.
Fuck, I can't believe there's been 17.
Yeah, I know.
Bodegas now, that's crazy.
Oh, P-Flats, I really like that, actually. I like the way you did it. It's a tricky art, okay, to tell a... Get exposition, get this sort of story out there in a way that is not, like, just two people talking, right? The whole having Floop's angle and stuff really made it just a lot... Brought it out, made it a lot more interesting. Added, like, a little bit more depth.
Thank you.
I like it. I like it a lot.
I like it a lot too.
You're doing fucking great job.
I'm proud of you, man.
Oh, you guys are the
very
best.
Much enjoying these.
It's just nuts.
Damn.
Yeah. That was a really good, long, weird little discussion. I really enjoyed, actually.
it was nice that it wasn't just about balls and dicks as well.
Yeah, we moved on to
we managed to actually have an interesting chat about something that probably nobody gives a shit about, but
very likely so.
Being old people, we like that. So.
Do we have a bodega?
We do.
Is it part 19?
It's part 18.
18.
Bodega. Part 18. I don't like it, said Bodega, glaring out of the viewport on the bridge of the Disco Volante. He stood, hands on hips, shaking his head, staring at his hideout that sat motionless in the small asteroid field. Maybe she's on vacation, said Nebish. I don't think so. She'd have told me, replied Bodega. He ran his hand down one side of his face, then the other. And Nebish thought for one moment he'd seen a tiny spark fly from Bodega's stubble. Nebish trusted Bodega's trouble sense more than he trusted the ship's sensors. He may have been a computer nut, but he also believed that evidence spoke for itself. Bodega was never wrong. If he thought there was trouble. End of story. Want to send Varu aboard? Check it out? Asked Nebish, cocking his head. Ain't fair to send him out there just because he's a robot, Neb, said Bodega, turning and walking towards the cargo hold. He is a robot, though. Why risk a life? He ain't a robot. He's a friend of mine, said Bodega. And that's that. Fine. Wish we had a drone or something, sighed Nebish. We'll go, called Bodega. And Rab too. And with that, Nebish could hear him readying his lasgun. 5 minutes later, they filed out of the Gretham insertion shuttle. Rab had his gore hammer ready, Bodega his las rifle, and Nebish his needle pistol. Reed had been needed back at corporate HQ for some big meeting, so he wasn't present, and Varu was staying behind on the Gretham. Sheila! Sheila! Called Bodega, rifle raised. Reckon she'd take off. Been away for a few weeks, man, said Rab, checking the corners of the docking port while sipping from a can of spatial brew. The base wasn't large enough to accommodate the Disco Volante, but if there was trouble, Rab was glad they hadn't put all their eggs in this one basket. Something else I'm worried about, said Bodega. Paulus! Bristled Rab, raising his hammer slightly. I got a message from Tan a couple days ago, said Bodega. Said he'd wired me the money up front. $500 million, Rab. That's the kind of money makes a friend an enemy.
Where did you find Sheila anyway? Asked Nevish.
Recruitment agency. Couldn't think of anyone I knew that would want to push papers and make scoffy all day, said Bodega ruefully. Flarv, what if she's done a runner with the Skrells? Asked Rab.
If she did, I'll find her, said Nebish, smiling.
Let's check the office, said Bodega.
They carefully moved through the cramped base, checking corners and angles, wary and ready for battle.
You guys check Sheila's office, I'll check mine, said Bodega.
Rab and Nebish began turning over papers on Sheila's desk. Nebish began checking her computer. As Bodega entered his office, he saw a note pinned to the whiteboard, a piece of paper folded in two. On the front it said, Bodega, so Bodega lifted the folded flap. He heard a tiny snick sound. Behind the flap, embedded in the whiteboard, was a small green disc about the size of his palm. It had a digital readout on the front that flashed into life, displaying red numbers, 00.04. That's a bomb then, thought Bodega calmly. When everything was about to go flarvy, Bodega's mind became tranquil. This was partly a gift and partly training. He'd also been in these kinds of situations so many times that he was able to assess each one with the detached nonchalance of a man mowing his lawn in his dressing gown. First things first, thought Bodega. Gotta seal this room. He glanced left and saw Rab about 5 meters away. Their eyes met for a split second, and Rab instantly knew just how flarvy things were about to get. That big Tartanian lug had the instincts of a Zarkpothian genius leopard. Bodega slapped the big red emergency vacuum seal button, and the door between him and Rab slammed shut with a surprisingly loud hiss and a hearty clonk. 00.03. Bodega began breathing as rapidly as he could. He was getting as much oxygen into his bloodstream as possible, because pretty soon he was going to have to empty his lungs. And last time he checked, 3 years ago, they still hadn't found a way to make space breathable. While he was doing this, he thumbed the wide-angle blast switch on his las gun and turned towards the viewport at the back of the office. 00.02. This was the spare second. Some more breathing. Bodega could see a small car-sized asteroid behind the base through the viewport. He leaned backward as much as he could and raised one leg in the air like he was about to start some kind of crazy drunken marching. He raised the rifle. 00.01. Bodega exhaled as hard as he could until he started to see stars around his peripheral vision. He pulled the trigger on the las gun. The rear of the room vanished in a blinding flash, and Bodega was blasted out into space along with everything around him. His desk, a moldy cup of scoffy, paperwork, his computer, a chair. 00.00. The tiny charge went off behind him, but Bodega was already traveling so fast he never felt it. He felt all the moisture on his tongue evaporate, and his eyeballs began to freeze over. He couldn't really see much of anything, and for the first time he heard real silence. The true, total silence of the void. He also saw that asteroid coming up real fast at his 12 o'clock. He brought his feet together so he looked like some kind of insane cowboy missile system in flight. His ground boots maybe had enough juice in them to slow him for impact. When the asteroid was scary close, he fired the boots by tapping the heels together just so. The G-force of the deceleration brought more stars to his already clouded vision, but a moment later he landed on the asteroid, a tiny plume of dust and pieces of rock erupting at his feet. He was about 5 seconds into this unwanted spacewalk, and he knew he had around 10 to 15 seconds left before he blacked out. He turned carefully to look back towards the base. One side of it was spewing gas into the void, and it listed badly, tumbling slowly so that it was about to go end over end. He could see the Disco Volante parked up around a kilometer away. He had to cross that distance soon, or he was going to die of being in space. Being in space was flarving awful. It was insanely cold, but he could also feel his skin burning badly from sunburn. His tongue was bone dry, his eyes freezing over like a windshield on a frosty morning. He was also starting to see beads of blood spill out into space, presumably from his body. Hell, he needed that red stuff inside him, he was pretty sure. Keep it together, pard, he told himself. Bending down carefully, he reached into his sock and pulled out a tiny shock charge. These things were mostly used for building entry. The blast was shaped so that a wave of force could be thrust through a wall to stun people on the other side. If he could plant the charge facing outwards, it might be able to get this little roid moving towards the disco. He slapped the charge on a spot he felt pretty sure was in line with the ship and ripped the go cord. A moment later, it went off silently, and Bodega noted with detached interest that the roid was now rocketing through space towards his ship, but was off angle by about 20 degrees. Close enough, maybe. He saw the Gretham spiral out of the dying station and begin burning away. The disco fired up his engines, and he saw it turning rapidly on the spot like a carousel. Varu looking for him. No time to run a scan, the robot was eyeballing it. 5 seconds left, till Bodega blacked out. The disco was around half a click now. He fired his las gun wildly into space, trying to get Varu's attention. It worked. The disco froze for a moment, then burned hard towards him. With the last of the juice in the scram boots, Bodega launched himself off his rocky steed and held one arm out in front. He guessed because his brain was saying, "Pard, that ship is moving awful fast towards you," as he began to black out before seeing Varu in the cockpit of the disco, and then nothing. Bodega awoke, feeling swollen and extremely flarvy in his bed aboard the Disco Volante. His friends gathered around him like a bunch of old grandmothers. Bodega sat up stiffly in bed. He looked around the room, blinked his scratchy eyes a few times.
"Okay, we got a new mission, fellas," he rasped. "I've decided I want to get my dog back." The end.
Oh, Bodega.
Bodega. Oh, that was cool. That was
That's
glorious.
A good one. That was tense.
I think I like countdown
episodes like that.
Like countdowns? Yeah. Love a good countdown.
I love a countdown. Love a good countdown.
I like a countdown.
I like the space. I like the space bit. I think I just like the words you choose for stuff. Like, I really like the way
Rocky Steed and
like,
stuff.
Yeah, and stuff like the Disco Volante burned towards him. That's like really nice kind of like space description, isn't it? It's really, really, really kind of like succinct, you know? Really nicely chosen, not wasting too many words. I like it a lot.
While we're on compliments, man, I saw a picture of you the other day and I thought, you know what? This guy would look great in like a calendar. Next to no clothes on.
Yeah. I think I'd have to wax my forearms to get in Lewis's calendar, apparently. He likes a shorn arm.